Good evening.
Good evening.
Tonight is Tuesday, and welcome to the October 14th Board of Selectmen Board Meeting. There being a full room tonight, that can only mean one thing. And I'd like to propose to take tonight's session slightly out of order and move directly to our badge pinning. So Chief Cormier, if you could help kick us off.
Thank you, I will.
Well, there you go.
Thank you, appreciate, again, the board's indulgence in welcoming us to do our badge pinning for newly hired and newly promoted police officers. It's been a tradition in the police department for many, many years, as long as I can remember. I know the officers and their families really appreciate the opportunity to be seen by the community and meet the Board of Selectmen as they progress through the ranks and get promoted, have their promotions recognized. So thank you again for finding the time. I know it takes a long time to set these things up. Tonight, because of the promotions and the hires that we're going to be recognizing tonight happened July 1st, and with the summer months, there was some consideration given to vacations and tight schedules, so we put the badge pinning off for a little bit. So I appreciate getting this in now, even though it feels like summer out anyway. Or it's just me, I'm not sure.
It's not him.
So this is kind of historic for us. We have 8 people to be pinned tonight, which as long as I can remember, we've never had so many. Usually 3, I think, is about the most I can remember at any one given time. And that's the result of some retirements and reorganization that occurred last year in the police department. So we're going to have two new patrol officers, 4 new sergeants pinned, and 2 new lieutenants this evening. Without any further ado, I think we'll start right into the program, and I'd like to introduce the 2 newest police officers, and I'll ask them to come up and stand by me, Officer Kaylin Gooley and Officer Matthew Orr. Another historic thing for this evening is that I'm reading from notes for this, because usually I only have 1 or 2 people I can do it right off the top of my head, but so as to not make any mistakes, I've written things down. I'd like to introduce Officer Kaylin Gooley. Officer Gooley is a bachelor's degree in criminal justice from Westfield State College. She's worked part-time as a police officer in Orleans, Massachusetts prior to coming here, along with being a campus police officer for Perry College, North Shore College, and most recently at Salem State University. During her time at Salem State University, she was able to attend police academy and came to us fully trained as a police officer. While attending the police academy up at Lowell, which is one of the academies that we use, Kaylin was president of her class. So this is Kaylin Gooley. Kaylin will be pinned tonight by her parents, Paul and Anne Marie. And then I'll just introduce Officer Orr, and we'll have the parents and the pinning people come up. Officer Matthew Orr worked as a police, has a bachelor's degree in criminal justice from Stonehill College. He's worked as a police officer for the Montville, Connecticut Police Department for the last 4 years. Montville is near one of the casinos down there, and Montville, from what I understand, keeps the police department very busy. The casino clients do, and Officer Orr brings a lot of experience with him. He attended the Connecticut Police Academy and graduated number 1 in his class in the Connecticut Police Academy. I will just point out that under the former hiring process that we had in the civil service, we've never seen either one of these officers or been able to hire them. One of the benefits with these 2 officers is they came fully trained and academy trained, and they've been working since the end of August for us, while the 3rd candidate we hired at that same time is still in the academy and will not be able to work until probably February. So we've been able to pick up some significant time and have them working in the street much earlier than normal. So Matthew will be pinned by his wife, Lisa. So if the pinners could come up, and the pinnees get prepared. We try not to draw blood with these. Hi, how are you? Congratulations.
Send in my pocket.
That's why they have best men.
Last one, my car.
No room there.
Lisa, that was a nice meet you. I'm sorry. Congratulations.
Thank you.
The the next group of officers that we're going to recognize is the newly promoted officer to sergeant. There'll be four of them. Sergeant Corey Santaski, Sergeant Patrick Silva, Sergeant Chris Jones, and Sergeant Christine Amendola. If you officers would come up here, please. So as I mentioned earlier, with the reorganization and some retirements, we're promoting four sergeants all at the same time, which I don't ever recall being done before in the Reading Police Department. This occurred on July 1st. Sergeant Corey Santaski has a bachelor's degree in criminal justice from Curry College. He worked as a school resource officer from February 2010 to July of 2014. He served with the U.S. Marine Corps from September 1999 to December 2004. He did two tours in Okinawa, Japan, and the American Embassy in Canberra, Australia, and Baku, Azerbaijan. He was hired by us in April 2006. Corey will be pinned by his wife Karen tonight. Sergeant Pat Silva, has a master's degree in criminal justice from UMass Lowell. Sergeant Silva attended the MBTA Police Academy. He's worked for the Middlesex Sheriff's Department from June 2004 to March 2009. He was hired by the Reading Police Department in March of 2009. He works as one of the department's field training officers. He will be pinned by his wife, Vanessa, and daughter, Sophia. Sergeant Chris Jones has a master's degree in criminal justice from UMass Lowell. He started off his career in the town of Reading working as a dispatcher from October 2006 to February 2008 when he was hired as a police officer. He attended the MBTA Academy in Quincy. He's also worked as an EMT for UMass Lowell, University of Massachusetts Lowell. And he is also one of the department's field training officers. He will be pinned by his wife, Kristen. And Sergeant Christine Amendola. Here it is. Currently pursuing a bachelor's degree in criminal justice at UMass Lowell. She served in the U.S. Army Reserves as a staff sergeant with military police from 1999 to 2012. Her tours included Bosnia, Iraq, and Afghanistan. She's a Bronze Star recipient. She was hired by the Reading Police Department in April 2006 and attended the MBTA Police Academy in Quincy. She's worked as the Department Safety Officer from May 2013 to July 2014. Worked as one of the department's FTOs and as a RAD instructor as well, and she's also worked in the department's accreditation and played a major role in the department receiving accreditation. Christine will be pinned by her husband, Andrew. I will mention, too, that this is the first female to be promoted above the rank of patrol officer in the Reading Police Department in our history. Right. People that are going to do the pinning would come up. Sergeant being promoted to the rank of Lieutenant, Lieutenant David Clark and Lieutenant Richard Abardi. Can you come forward? Yeah. Lieutenant Clark has a master's degree in criminal justice from Western New England College. He served in the U.S. Army as a military police officer with tours in Panama, Iraq, and Cuba. Hired by the Reading Police Department in April of 1995, he attended the Canton Police Academy. Lieutenant Clark runs both the field training officer program as well as the RAD program. He's responsible for the department hiring process since leaving civil service, which has been very successful. He will be pinned tonight by his sons, Hayden and Logan. Lieutenant Richard Abadi has a master's degree in criminal justice from UMass Lowell. He was hired as police officer in July 2005 and attended the Lowell Police Academy. He became the town's first school resource officer from 2006 to 2010. He's a member of the Reading Coalition Against Substance Abuse and the School Threat Assessment Team through the NEMLIC organization. He's worked on the department's accreditation and played a major role also in the department receiving accreditation. Lieutenant Abadi will be pinned by his daughters Avery and Jillian. Those Avery and Jillian and Hayden and Logan will come up. So, as is usual at these events, and I dread this part of the night most of all, because I usually go around and introduce all the Reading police officers that are here, and I saw they brought a ringer in from Wakefield to try to throw me off. But I would like to just take a minute and recognize the officers that are here, and they usually have somebody in the audience in plainclothes too, to see if I can miss see if I can get everybody. You've met all the officers that have been pinned tonight, so I'll start with Deputy Chief Mark Segala. Next to him is Wakefield Police Officer Chris Whalen. And we have Officer Keith Hurley, Sergeant Kevin Brown, Officer Michael Skelton, Sergeant Silver, Sergeant Jones, Lieutenant Executive Officer, Lieutenant Richard Robbins. Lieutenant Robbins would like to let everybody know that he has how many days left?
38 working days.
38 working days. Detective Derek Holmes, Officer Mark Mullen, School Resource Officer Mike Rulo, Sergeant Santaski. Detective Pat Iapica is sitting down in the yellow shirt. Is there anybody else that I've missed? Lieutenant Cheryl from the Canton Police Department is here for one of the officers. She's here, she's friends of Lieutenant Clark. And Joe, I didn't get the last name. Help me out.
Salvo.
Say it again.
Salvo.
From the Gloucester Police Department. And Andrew Amendola is in Brookline. So there's a whole bunch of policemen in the room. I'd like to thank you all for attending. It really means a lot to the officers. Mr. Chairman, thank you for your time, and I'm sure the officers and the people in the audience really appreciate you taking time out of your busy schedule.
My pleasure.
These officers.
Our pleasure.
Thank you.
An evening night tonight makes me think of two things. Who's left patrolling the streets? And as Chief Cormier went through the litany, the resume of work histories, foreign assignments, military service, prior notable achievements, it reminds me that we in Reading are getting the best of the best. That in part, the discussion you had on civil service, we're picking people that we want to be part of our team and have the best credentials and come, in most cases, fully trained. I couldn't be more proud. In this day and age, when I was a kid, police officers, I think the role was very different than it is today. There's so many more challenges. And part of the life skills and work skills that this group brings forth helps make Reading the very special place that we all call home. I can't also be impressed by the number of colleagues from other towns that have chosen to come here tonight as well. So thank you all for coming. Some of my other colleagues may wish to say something. John?
Yeah, I did want to say something because this is the second time in a week that I've been in this room with most of these fine gentlemen and ladies that represent Reading on their police force. I was here last Thursday night in a very age-appropriate way, I might add, at the Senior Citizens Hammer Meet. And it was beyond what all of these men and women do to protect us, to take care of our streets, to take care of our citizens. It was so heartwarming to watch them. The room was filled with tables and senior citizens being served and taken care of and seated and just kind of almost group hugged. And I can't tell you how heartwarming that was. And I want to take the opportunity to thank all of you in public once again for that. I don't know if everybody in town realizes the things that you all do that go above and beyond. And I'm watching your countdown over there. I think you were at 43 last time we were together. I just want to thank all of you and make special note of what you do for the community in so many different ways.
Thank you.
Any other comments?
That concludes the pinning ceremony. For all of those who are riveted on the rest of our agenda, you're welcome to stay. We'll give a few minutes to clear the room if you'd like to enjoy some of the seasonal weather we've got here tonight.
Mr. Chair, if they could just have a minute or two to take some pictures.
Absolutely, yeah. Absolutely. Why don't we have 3, 4, or 5 minutes while we're taking it?
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
Congratulations.
We have a full agenda, so as the party continues over at various households and perhaps at Grumpy Doyle's,
why don't we pick it up here? I'm going to dispense with the liaison's comments. We have a posted hearing at 7:30, but is there any public comment at this time? I'll open the floor to public comment. Okay. Seeing none, we'll proceed. Bob, any quick comments to augment your town manager's?
Just one comment on an agenda item. Ricky's liquor license suspension at 7:30. We put that in as a placeholder should the ABCC send us any notification today. They did not do that, so there's no need to take that article up tonight.
Okay. Good. That being the case, I'd like to move out of order and take up the town accountant report. In our packages on Thursday was the report from Sharon Angstrom in its written form. We heard a version of it in one of the prior financial forums, also in this room. But this is the first I'd seen the notes in their current form. So Sharon, did you have any comments to augment your prepared notes?
I just wanted to kind of draw your attention to the timeline. Marcy had requested I draw up a timeline, and I had forgotten about it and didn't include it in the packet. So the timeline just kind of tells you about when the trucks were removed from service, when the letters were sent to the communities offering the trucks to each one of the user communities, and then when the ad was run. And just a timeline so you could get a feel for how the transaction transpired and when things took place, when I requested things, when I received things. So I think you get an idea of the timeline. I don't know if you want me to go over it or if you want to review it yourself. And I just kind of wanted to just give you a kind of brief review of what I did. I mean, we talked about it at the last meeting in terms of what I'd already done. And Colleen had supplemented with some of the information that she was able to attain from their counsel, stating that this transaction fell as a violation against Chapter 268A, Section 20. She notified the employee of this violation, and the transaction eventually was reversed because if he remedied the situation within 30 days, he wouldn't be prosecutable. And after that was done, I'd asked for information in terms of, I just wanted to be sure that the trucks were in fact returned and that the title was turned over to RMLD, and that, you know, that just to know that really did happen. I requested that information. It took a couple weeks to get it. I was kind of confused by it because I was like, well, it was just signing over the title, you know. But it took a couple weeks for me to get that. I did get that, but I didn't get all of them. I got one. And it was the one that had already been registered and the other two hadn't been registered. So I was under the understanding that the other two needed to go through the RMV to be reissued back to Armonte. So I think that's why I didn't see that one, but I just wanted to make that clear that I didn't see all three. I only saw the one. I saw the three bill of sales signing them back to Armonte, so I felt fairly comfortable with that.
Your report is is complete, and I have no personal comments or questions. Is any other member of the board?
No.
Any public comment on the report? Colleen, I see you in the audience tonight. I'm sure you have a... Why don't you come up? There's a microphone up here.
Otherwise, having a hard time hearing your...
The room doesn't lend itself. The room doesn't lend itself to it. Come on up. Yeah, sure.
Thank you for having me. I have Jane Parento, the head of our integrated resources and planning, with us tonight. And Sharon. I appreciate you allowing me to come and address the Board of Selectmen on RMLD's policy number 2 on surplus material. The previous policy, as we all know, lessons learned, is well over 20 years old and was in desperate need of updating. After Board of Commissioners had a policy review committee, I recommended that all 31 policies be sent out for legal and political scrubbing, of which they all have been sent out. Policy number 2 was the first and foremost in the priority, and number 9 and 19, which also deal with some procurement, are the second ones on the docket, and they'll be up by next month. The RMLD understands that both the town and the schools will be reviewing their procurement policies, and the RMLD will consider any and all changes that come out of those reviews and incorporate any of those revisions that will strengthen and be in the best interest of RMLD. The trucks were returned, and we are in the process of following the revised policy. The trucks are in the yard, and has everyone been able to find the policy on the RMLD website?
It's under. Confused, but I think when I went online, I thought the old one, but then I was told that maybe there were revisions on the old one, so
yeah,
I wasn't quite sure. Maybe I saw the old one, saw Benny's signature on the old date, and I didn't continue looking at that one. But was the modifications made to the old one, or was it a whole new one?
There was a whole new one there. It just...
There was a link from David Talbot, but when I linked on that, when I clicked on that link, it still brought me to the old one. So I had trouble...
You have kind of the old town, the old website, and then we were adopting what the town was doing with their upgrades to the website. If you go on the website and you go under About Us and then RMLD Policies, they're PDF'd in, so you just have to scroll to number 2.
Okay,
I had a very difficult time finding it. I tried to find it on the website, and I did a search, and I wasn't able to find it.
Go to the...
I was trying to find it just so that I could kind of assess, you know, is everything covered that I think needs to be covered, and that's why I went looking for it, and I had trouble. But, I mean, if it's there, it's there. But
go to About Us at the top. Go to RMLD Policies, and then
it's
all the policies there. Just scroll down to number 2.
RMLD is not the only one with a confusing website. We're making steady progress.
We're actually working on an internal website through SharePoint and an external website to make it a lot easier, and maybe to adopt some of one of the larger utilities do more towards customer service and customer programs. So it's on the list of things that we're working on. But I do want to point out RMLD's core mission, which is really reliability, which I will tell you that we're at 95 percentile in the state, which is pretty good. And we have a lot of maintenance programs that we're working on, and we're trying to get the system to stay at 95 percentile, because those are pretty high statistics relative to the rest of the state. And when I do the reliability statistics, I don't leave out small blinks or anything like that that a lot of the large utilities do, because I want to look at every single blink so that we can find out what's causing it and correct it, whether it's trees or animals or whatever. So 95 percentile is extremely good for reliability. We are also the third lowest rate in the state, which is pretty amazing. That's out of about 45 utilities, and we'd like to keep it that way. About 80% of our budget is power supply, and that's where a lot of our focus is to keep the golden egg of the electric system reliable and on target to meet the future because the electrics industry itself is going to become even more volatile than it has in the past. We have transmission and capacity increases that are coming down, which is why I did a six-year transparent budget, so that I am able to sit with the town managers of each of the four towns, and everybody's prepared for anything that could happen way in advance of their budget. But I've been working really hard to make sure that we can stabilize the rates and again, keep them the lowest. And third lowest in the state is, again, it's pretty commendable for RMLD. We are now approximately at 14 cents, whereas I'm sure you read in the paper, National Grid is at 24.1 cents. So, pretty significant. The RMLD is also undergoing a comprehensive organizational study where we're looking to all of the processes improvements, all of the skill sets of all of the employees, where perhaps some employees were put into positions without proper mentoring, so the skill sets and the career development in order to develop those employees, because again, we want to get on track to be able to be competitive in the future. As well as that, we'll be looking at succession planning and a lot of other little things that were not taken care of in the past, possibly by previous managers. Along with the organizational study, we're doing a complete system reliability plan, of which will be the foundation of our 20-year strategic plan. The system has to be flexible in order so that we can, you know, be able to call out to it so that it can flex during peaks. That's how we're going to be able to save the money. So a lot of work is going into both the organizational and the reliability studies, and those were just awarded about a week and a half ago, so we're looking forward to getting underway with those consultants that are coming in. We picked Leidos, which is formerly R.W. Beck, as well as Booth & Associates will be doing the reliability study. We plan to develop these 20-year strategic plans and continue to operate efficiently and competitively and successfully in this volatile industry as we go forward. And that's what I had to add, and I appreciate you having me. And as we go forward, any feedback you have from what you're getting out of the other procurement policies, please pick up the phone and or we can meet and be glad to make those type of visions. The policies per se do not come under my purview, if you know that. They come under the commission, so I can only ask through policy committees for reviews. So it's not a process that can be very quick other than recommendations.
Many of your comments, Colleen, speak to self-improvement, continuous improvement,
yes.
Benchmarking against peer organizations. It's clear there's a lot of planning that's in sight or even underway. A lot of that's going to collect the interest of the citizenry of the town. And one of the areas of that I'm most interested in is a continued collaborative relationship between the commission and this board. There's no formal connection, but just as the RMLD Board of Commissioners is elected by the citizenry, so are we. And to the extent that the two are both here to serve the citizenry, the dialogue in all cases ought to be collegial and collaborative and constructive. And it hasn't always been that way. We've tried to be, and perhaps the commentary here and even meetings like this might be misconstrued, but or at least speaking for myself, my intention has only been to further the interest of the citizens. I don't believe in gamesmanship or creating confrontation for confrontation's sake. And as from my perspective, the report stands as written. Sharon may have some amendments that she creates just out of tonight, but this is completely out of the hands of the Board of Selectmen. The FinCom will do a fine their own review, and I'm sure we'll do a fine job in the course of doing it, but I'm looking towards the continued spirit of collaboration and transparency.
Absolutely.
And I'd open the floor to any of my colleagues' comments, if any.
Okay, well, may I suggest, I mean, I'm asking for an upcoming meeting to come and talk about a number of topics.
Sure.
And what I've done in my previous job is that, you know, when I can get on the agenda, usually maybe every other month, come in and kind of give an update of, you know, maybe you'd want to know how is the organizational reliability study going, or maybe when they're done, come and give a quick presentation. I know you don't have a lot of time, and I could always pare it down to just a few slides. But I will be coming to talk about the LED pilot that we're doing and how well that's going, and whether you like the lights, and to, that we've created a Gmail account so that we can talk to the citizens and get their input. We'll be talking about tree trimming. We'll be talking about some of the programs that we're offering, including a charging station for both residential and commercial customers for electric charging station. You can get yourself a nice BMW electric car. And just keep you up to date with everything that we're doing. You know, I think since I've gotten there, everything that I've done has been transparent. We went from a 1 year, that's all we look at budget, and now if you look at my budget, it says what I did last year, what I spent year to date, what I'm doing this year, and even though they're only voting on that year, I tell you what we're gonna do for the next 5 years. So that I can get comments on everything. I mean, I'm an engineer by trade, and the way that we work is ideas work better on top of each other. So that's how I think. Those are what think tanks are. I just happen to be a manager and an engineer, but so I'm always welcome to you know, share the information. We can always get a better idea and build on top of someone else's idea and come up with the best. I just want to keep Reading. I mean, I was hired as a rehabilitator. It was recognized that a lot of work needed to be done and get people in line to meet the future. And that's what I've come in to do. And I'm creating a lot of change, and I know that change is difficult, but it doesn't bother me. So that's what I do for a living. So I just, I'll keep going. And if people have comments or they want to steer or whatever, there's plenty of opportunity to talk to the commission. But I, for one, will be collaborative and provide updates to the FinCom, to you guys, whatever you can fit me in your schedule. I'll be glad to bring people with me.
We would love to see your board with you on at least some of those occasions. I think it's good to have board-to-board interactions as well.
Okay.
If that could be set up on a regular basis.
It probably goes both ways.
Yeah.
Okay, I will
make
that.
Could do a home and home. I don't have a problem.
Yeah. The other, I have no doubt about the operational efficiency of RMLD in terms of its generating capacity, its cost per kilowatt hour. What would be most interesting would be to talk about the strategic planning and
yes.
the long-term planning.
Right.
Might be worthwhile having a dedicated meeting just to talk about what are the items that might be most useful to get a quarterly brief or a twice annual brief on. Just in terms of sharing or,
okay.
and out of that can come both the frequency and the content rather than trying to do it on the fly here.
Are you speaking before the consultants come in and kind of lay out the scope that I wrote in the RFP or a presentation after they start with an update?
I wasn't trying to
oh.
prescribe any outcome,
okay.
merely to respond to your point about providing a brief. It would
okay.
be helpful to kind of get this board sense of what would be useful to talk about what's possible and then find that short list of things that periodically could get an update. I'm not talking about specificity to anything you might have underway with consultants.
Okay.
Does
okay.
that make sense?
Yes.
Absolutely. Any other comments from the board?
Yeah, John.
Bob?
Right now, Colleen is scheduled to come in on the 18th of November and see the board. We have it as a 9 o'clock agenda item, but I will say, depending on
yep.
some tax classification moves, I expect you'll have a hearing on October 28th. If that doesn't happen because the DOR is not ready, that will happen on the 18th. So we'll have to just let Colleen know around the end of October what the real time is.
That's fine.
Is there a subject for that?
That's the
LED program.
He's got the LED
okay.
program, the organizational, and the system reliability studies.
Okay.
Great.
Yeah.
Great.
And I was going to talk briefly about tree trimming. We've met with the DPW director and the tree warden just to go over that a little bit. We're going back out for bids to have a much more efficient tree trimming. It's 36% of what causes the outages. But the existing way that it's tree trimmed, we can be a lot more efficient. We can directional prune, and we can save some money, and we can get it done quicker a lot more efficient, because it is a very costly, but it is the highest reliability issue. But we all love trees, and we want to make sure that we keep the aesthetics of the trees, you know, the health of the trees intact. And I know that that's sensitive to the people in Reading. So if there's anything else that you'd like to add to me, I will be very careful to just have a couple of quick slides with a couple of quick bullets. I can always meet with Bob afterwards to give him more information, but it'll just be quick. I won't, you know, labor on the discussion.
They have a wide open agenda that night, so.
Okay, so if there's anything else you want.
Thank you for your comments.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you very much.
Okay.
Any other comments? If not, we'll move on to the
the fee discussion. That's what I need to talk about.
I don't think I had a couple of things I wanted to share with you about the town one. There's a town chairman.
Oh, please.
I just wanted to give you an update, because I don't think I've given you any information.
Please.
No, please do.
I'm sorry. We had received an anonymous letter regarding the transaction between an employee in the DPW office, alleging the same sort of transaction as RMLD. It was found on the website, and it was, you know, all the backup was attached to the anonymous letter. I'm stating this person works for Public Works. How were they able to purchase this truck? That section of the law, Chapter 268A, Section 20A, there can be an exemption that allows an employee to make a purchase. And I had to call the State Ethics Commission to understand it myself, so it's hard to imagine how an employee would understand it if they didn't call State Ethics to find out. But I called and I spoke to an attorney there who stated there's three things that have to happen in order for an employee to qualify for that exemption. First is that they can't work for the contracting agency. I'm like, well, what's the contracting agency? Isn't it the town? Wouldn't that be nobody? The contracting agency is the department selling the asset. So in this case, it was engineering putting this asset up for sale, and it was a highway employee purchased. And so they both fall under Public Works. So in this instance, I feel that this person probably shouldn't have been able to purchase. As far as the procurement on this, it was a 1996 Chevy dump truck, and the person paid $21.95 for it. It was a sealed bid. There was four or five other bids, and it was the high bid. As far as procurement goes, it didn't look off to me, although in the letter there was an actual printout of a similar truck for sale for $15,900. Now, this truck only cost $34,000 brand new in 1996. It's hard to imagine it would keep half its value, but it was also a website that was, it looked like a used truck car dealership, not an auction site. What I was able to get for, you know, comps using what we might use, which is Gov Deals or Muni Bids, was in the range of $700 to $3,300, depending on how good the condition of the trucks were. The trucks, when I asked about condition, because I got maintenance records, which I haven't actually gone all the way through because it's been such a busy time for me, but when I asked about the condition of the trucks from various parties, what I got was that these trucks were in terrible condition and very rusted, and, you know, a list of things that were rusted out and broken and all that. And I didn't feel that they were comparable to what was printed out and sent to me, but I haven't done all the way to find out, is there a problem with value, although on the face of it, it doesn't appear to me there is a problem. We got $21.95, and the top bid that I could find on an auction website was like $3,300, and that was a truck that appeared to be in very good condition. So I'm not, on the face of it, the procurement doesn't look off to me, except that when I asked the question of, was anything done to assess the value before you signed off on the bid? And I think that's a step that's commonly missed, because a lot of people think, well, there's multiple bidders, it's worth what somebody's willing to pay. That's the answer you'll typically get. And I think that that's one thing that the town will improve on and start really kind of considering. Do we have an idea of what it's worth before we put it out to bid, so we can prove that we did our due diligence? Because I think it's the piece that got missed at RMLD. It's getting missed at the town side. I still feel that what they got was probably what it was worth, but I'm still looking at that. And I've provided all of this information to FinCom as part of their review of both RMLD, the school, the town. I don't know if the school has a specific transaction that they're interested in, but they are going to look at all, and all that information has been forwarded to them. I just figured I'd give you the update, because I don't think we've had the discussion at all since I got the letter, because it's happened after I had my last presentation. So I figured I would just give you that and open it up for any questions you might have about that transaction.
And the real question I would have is are we getting, it goes back to this best value, and the wider audience you can get for this stuff, those of us that have bought or are planning to buy motor vehicles or constantly searching the internet to get you know, what's market rate for this? And I'm sure there's a vehicle to do the same on the sell side with these used vehicles.
Which is what we ended up doing after the fact, is going on to like places like GovDeals and Unique Bids, auction sites, online auction sites that reach a lot bigger of a window, and finding what the valuations are of similar trucks, similar age. And that's where I got the 700 to 3,300. So I feel like we're right in the ballpark there. But I think there might be a little bit more that I can do there. I could even reach out to the same gentleman over at Universal Machinery and see what his thoughts are on the value of that truck, and did we sell it inappropriately. The person who did purchase it sold the truck as parts, like sold off the parts.
Sure.
So the truck wasn't something that could be used, apparently. So it's not like he can return it. And so he's in a different situation, so they could come back on him, and I don't know that. And I feel like our policy should have something in it that helps us protect them from making this mistake. Our understanding of how they have the exemption will help, because then we can say, I don't think you qualify, you need to call state ethics. And that was what the state ethics attorney said to me. When anybody's considering entering into something like this, purchasing something from the town, they should probably be calling us individually, telling us their circumstance, telling us who's, you know, give us all the details so we can tell them, yes, you qualify, no, you don't. And they're perfectly willing to do that, and it's something that we should probably be advising people before they enter into these things, because the violation isn't on the town, but on the employee, and they could be prosecutable, and they don't even realize they're making this mistake. So it would be nice for us to find ways to protect them. The problem we have at the town side is that they can have this exemption, so you can't completely prohibit it, because they have the right to bid it, and you know, to bid on things that, in departments that they don't work in. And so then if you take it away, you've kind of got to bargain it away, and that comes at a cost. So it really ties our hands in some way. So I just figured I'd give you that update, because I hadn't prior. But we do have a whole separate presentation for fees. I don't know, where would you like me to sit for
a second? I have a question on
this,
if you don't mind. Sharon, a couple of things come to mind as you were talking about the situation that presented itself. One of them is, could we incorporate into our process with employees of the town that we require that they need to call to the Ethics Commission?
That was something I was asking Bob, if maybe we should ask town council if that's something we can. In order to bid, you have to have some confirmation that you
if you're going to bid on something.
Some email that you got back from them saying, yes, precisely, we agree that you have the exemption, and then we'll agree to the transaction. The other thing that has to be in play is they have to disclose their interest to the town clerk before the transaction is complete. In this situation, he failed to do that as well. So even if you viewed his department as far enough away, you know, he's a part of Public Works, it was a division of Public Works. If you kind of were able to get there, he didn't fill out the disclosure form in all three things. You have to have, you can't work for the contracting agency. It has to be a public notice, so it has to be put up to bid or auction or whatever, and they have to disclose their interest to the town clerk. And he missed two of those.
It seems to me that we ought to have a checklist of those things that you just
now that we understand them ourselves.
That needs to be signed off by the person accepting the bid. And I would add that person be required, if we can do such a thing, I guess we have to check with the town council, but you know, in my mind, the right way to do this is you have a checklist before a person can accept a bid from an employee.
Yeah.
That checklist has to be signed off. I would add this phone call, email, interaction, you know, to the State Ethics Commission.
The other thing is we're using a lot more online auction sites, which is almost the third party is selling the asset, and then that brings enough separation
Absolutely. The
employee isn't even on the cup. But if we happen to do it the old-fashioned way where we're listing it, you know, because
the
it's
cheaper
that way.
The other thing is the amount of time that it's out there advertised.
Yeah.
So a single day, definitely not long enough. It needs to be an amount of time that's long enough and to the right target audience that you're assured that the we get back is going to be the best possible dish. Right?
So, I mean, from these transactions happening, we're all learning about that law that's out there that we need to be aware of and what we need to know so that this doesn't happen again. So.
Well, the last question I have, and it's more of a practical nature, auctions in general, sometimes it's whoever makes the highest bid gets the prize.
Yeah.
In others, there's a reserve. So if we know going in that we feel like there's a reserve of, let's say in this case, the reserve was $2,000, great.
Yeah.
If the reserve was $2,500, because the range was up to $3,300 or $3,500, that would not be inappropriate to put a reserve clause on the auction, number one. And then number two, should nobody hit the reserve, then you go to the highest bidder and say, well, we had this at a reserve of X, would you like to meet the reserve? And if, I mean, those little mechanical steps will, I think, go a long way to make sure that we get fair market on these things. And, you know, put the employee side away for a second, because I think there's a process that we should be implementing, just in general, so that we get fair value. A reserve on the auction is not inappropriate and doesn't cost us anything.
Absolutely.
You know, to put the reserve.
Because then it ensures that you're not falling below what we consider to be our assessed value.
And that way, if we didn't hit the right target audience, or we.
We could try rebidding it again. And,
correct.
You know, sometimes it just doesn't get seen. And that could have been the case with the Irma.
Could be a timing thing.
But the more places it's posted, I mean, the thing that I found with this transaction is we put it out in Goods and Services. It's on our website. It's in the newspaper. So it was in several locations where it could potentially be seen and picked up. And that helps. The more places people can see it, the more often, you know, the more bids you're going to get. So in this case, we did get multiple bidders. The employee happened to be the high bidder. I disagree that he had the right to purchase, but he did purchase, and so there's the problem in that transaction. And the fact that I feel like we could be doing a better job of assessing the value of what goes in. So.
Sharon, thank you for all your time and energy.
Thank you.
And hopefully we can get your attention focused on the finances of the town. I know this has taken just an inordinate amount of time, your own time.
So.
But thank you again from the board.
So where would you like me to sit? Where would it be most?
Can the board see this?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. Maybe if we kill, can we kill like half the lights, or does that ruin the ambiance? This has got like a cave feeling to it, doesn't it? That's
there,
better.
That's better. Okay.
Bob had directed me to ask the department heads to look at the fees in their areas and do some analysis on the fees that stood out as maybe problematic, that they haven't been changed in a long time, or that they're high or they're low. Do some analysis to peer communities and give me those numbers, the ones that you think might need to be changed. So you're only going to see ones that you feel could potentially be changed. And don't feel any pressure to vote anything tonight. I just wanted to give you this information. You can sit on it, do what you want with it, but I just didn't want to have that pressure. There's a couple slides that certainly couldn't be put into effect right away, and I think that the goal is really for, if we do make any changes, to be as of January 1 or July 1, so it wouldn't be something we're looking to take effect for.
Do we have a copy of this in our packet?
I didn't see it on the
not of the PowerPoint.
No. Okay.
I can get you that.
Yeah.
Just a further comment on that. I would suggest this comes up as it typically does as your January budget discussion, further discussion.
So this is
when Sharon mentioned July or January implementation dates, that's a year from now. So for instance, there's one item I'd suggest if you do anything, it's January 1st of 2016. And then there could be things for July of 2015. And if the board recalls last year when we had the similar discussion, the suggestion was to change ambulance fees as of July 1st. The board actually said, let's just do them sooner. So that's always your option.
So here in January of 15.
In January 15,
or July,
make your decisions. Right. Yes.
Makes sense.
This first slide is just the revenues in the areas where we have some potential changes. So you can count all of our fee revenues. And you can see that the revenues for fiscal 14 and the areas that we're looking to make changes are very, very small. I think if you eliminate the resident parking and compost, the total of those revenues is about 155. So any change that we're making is not material, and it's not big changes, but it's just stuff that maybe falls well below the average. We're trying to stay somewhere in the middle in most cases, and you'll see that with the slides.
This is really hard with over 50 eyes.
Is there a way to make that?
I'm going to just move up.
Yeah.
Why don't we all just relocate to the front of the projector?
There we go.
Yeah, I think that's the easiest.
I don't think we're normally this far away.
No.
I don't want to make y'all feel bad.
You can see it just right behind.
You got six people up here.
Kevin said he can see it.
I'm going to go over the list. It's easier if you can read them yourself. $5 fee. Flammable storage is not something that's widely done, but we won't charge a $10 fee for the permit, and an average is 43. So he still wants to stay somewhere in the middle, go with 25. Daycare inspections, we actually don't have a fee, and I guess we do a fair amount of these inspections, and he felt like the time is worth something, and we should get some of that back. So he went with a low-ball $25 fee. Gunpowder storage, again, not a lot of permits for that, but we only charge 15. The average is 34, looking to go to 25. The single-family smoke detector and the two-family smoke detector inspections, those are done more frequently and might have a little bit more impact than some of the ones above. But again, we fell, you know, below the average, and it looks like he wants to go a little higher than the average, and it must be because we do quite a bit of this and want to get the value for the time.
So is this the chief making these recommendations?
Yes, the chief is making it. He knows more than I would about these areas.
Is that the fee per detector installed or the fee per unit?
I think it's per the, per, from
for the inspection.
For the inspection to come up and do the inspection, it's for their time, really. Miscellaneous permits, there wasn't a lot of time. What is a miscellaneous permit? It's like sometimes we're asked to inspect things like tents and sprinklers, and now he wants the sprinklers, so the next one down is sprinklers, he wants that separated. Just various things, and it was hard to find a comparable, but it's still at $15 where everything seems to be moving up to the 25. He felt it was, you know, a good idea to try and push those up to 25 because just for the time for these miscellaneous permits. And the sprinkler used to be a miscellaneous permit. He feels we do enough of these sprinkler permits that they should have their own separate line, so it's clear when people are looking at their list of pricing what that costs.
In all cases, these are visits, or are they just a routine issue?
Sometimes it's just getting a permit too, but I would think most of it is that they do some level of inspection to give you the permit.
So before you leave there, do we know how much money that the current fees represent on this slide?
Well, actually the first slide, if we go back to that, fire inspections and permits only $21,000.
I couldn't see that.
We're not talking big dollars here. It's not going to be this huge addition, but it is
not going to fill our revenue gap.
No, but it definitely is areas where we're low and we do require a little thought about it. And the community,
it all counts.
Okay, it all counts. Every little bit counts. Let's just say that the community service permit fee proposals were widely in the plumbing, gas, and electrical inspections. And you can see for one fixture for residential plumbing, we were at $22. The average is 50. They're just looking to go to 45. Commercial plumbing, one fixture, we're currently charging 55. The average is 97. They're looking to go round it up to 100. Residential gas, one fixture, 22, again to 45. You can see that the trend is to try and keep them within the, you know, a lot of them the same, 45 for the gas and plumbing. And then the electrical outlets, 1 to 10 outlets, they're at 22. And apparently this $22 figure is problematic for view permit. It has some sort of a complication calculating it at $22. And they said it would be easier if it was 25. But as it turns out, peer communities, it's around 28. So 25 is a more reasonable number anyway.
Looks like the rates used to be 20 and 50. And way back when it was, let's do a 10% upward.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And there you go. Any idea when that might happen?
And you're back, that's definitely
16.
You know, these are the ones that clearly, you know, things that they thought needed to be changed. There's probably other potentials, but these were the ones. Street opening and occupancy engineering helped me with this one. And they basically said that for street openings, there basically is the same amount of effort no matter what they're doing the street opening for. And so they felt that these should be all the same. And they also felt that they were low. And when you look at the peer communities, they do fall on the low end when you see the range, low to high. And there was also some consideration of different peer communities charge things in a different way. So sometimes it wasn't exactly as comparable, exactly what we're doing to how they bill it, a little bit different. And so that's why we went with low to high, because we couldn't average it out because in some cases it's billed entirely different. And so that's why we show you a low and a high to give you a feel.
So is the engineer, the town engineer, making the recommendations
yes,
here?
Yes, the town engineer is making the recommendation. Sewer permit, same thing. He said all of this, installation, disconnect, repair, when you're doing a sewer, all the same amount of effort for engineering, so they want all the fees the same. They're currently all at 75, they want them to be 100, and then they show the peer communities, and the same is true, we went low and high instead of average, because there were several communities just to fall in line with the exact way we do it. Water fees, you're not going to see any comparables, because we're kind of unique in that we own the lines right up to the meter, and so most work is done on the town, you know, as part of our infrastructure. But if a customer is to request any of these, we actually charge a fee, and the fee has been in place for so long, for like the three-quarter valve replacement or the one-inch valve replacement, that it doesn't even cover the cost of what the actual valve is, and that's all they're asking for, is to go up to the cost of what it costs them to do it. Not even the manpower to do it, but the cost of the actual parts. The meter test, sometimes when people have high water bills, they ask to have their meter tested to see that if it runs, you know, runs fast. I'm told that they do these tests a lot in that they've never found the meters to be running fast. If anything, it might run slow. But they know, so they only charge the fee if the meter is running, you know, appropriately. So in most cases, that's what they find. And so for their time, they want to go from 15 to 50 because they do a lot more. hydrant test flow is basically when they have a sprinkler design or a new development. Customer will request a hydrant test flow, and it requires us to put an ad out to let the people in the community know that we're doing this, because when they flow a hydrant, apparently sediment is released, and the water can look dirty, and people can be alarmed by this. This will be giving them forethought that this is what the problem is. It's very short term, but it's one of those things that they don't want people to be alarmed about their water.
How is that related to sprinkler systems?
He said that when they're doing a sprinkler system design, when somebody's putting a new house in or something, that would be a reason somebody might ask them for a hydrant flow, but most of the time it's new houses, new developments that they do.
So that's outside the normal hydrant flushing cycle?
Yes.
It's like a Home Depot.
These are things that are requested by the customer. Now, if there's ever like a leak in our water system, we're replacing that stuff, and so it's very hard to find comparables, because when you call other communities, they're like, that's the homeowner's issue, that if there's a leak, they need to call a contractor, and we don't do that. And so that's why you don't see any real comparables here, because we really are unique in the fact that we own right up to the meter, and if there's a leak, we take care of it. A lot of times, some of these things might come up where, why don't this valve replace, because, you know, I don't think my water pressure is good enough. But, you know, they might come out and inspect and say, I think it's fine. And if they're going to insist, they're going to get charged. The tapping fee is for a new house, and it's to tap the main to the water. And incidentally, neither one of these have a fee at all. And they want to, you know, obviously charge $75 for the hydrant test flow, plus the cost of the ad to notify the people in the neighborhood that you're going to have maybe a period where your water will be clean, and then the tapping, they're looking to do $250. I'm not sure where he bases the $250 for the tapping fee, but that's the suggestion from engineering.
You get the sense for most of those, it's driven by the materials cost?
Yes, most, yeah, I mean, it seems like they're really trying to get the cost of what they have to use. I mean, when they're doing a valve replacement, to be at $30 and know that it costs them more than that to actually get what the part is, that's what they're trying to absorb for the most part. Hydrant test flow and the tapping fee, there's got to be a certain amount of manpower that they're trying to cover the love. And connecting to the stormwater or the drainage for the town, we currently don't have a fee, and they're just asking to add the same fee that you would have for water and sewer, which is the $75. And he said we only do about six of these, and it's usually when people want to connect their sump to our drainage system. And so I don't know, we just never had a fee, and I just want to propose a fee, and they give you an idea of high-low for peer communities. The other thing that they do in engineering is these plan scans, and they don't do them for everyone. They only do it for people where they really need an electronic copy of the plan scan, and they want $5 per page. I think they might be sending them out, because he gave me pricing from a company, and so they're looking to just cover their cost on it. And right now, they're kind of trying to get them to go out and do it elsewhere, because otherwise we're absorbing that cost. So. And soil test witness inspection, they don't charge for it, but they actually are out there witnessing these soil tests
and they're out there 2 to 6 hours. And this is the fee that they came up with. It seems low if somebody's out there for 2 to 6 hours, and sometimes they have to be out there multiple times for additional testing. So they're proposing a $25 fee plus $10 for each additional test that they have to go out there.
Is that for bearing strength or for percolation?
I'm not entirely sure. It didn't give me a lot of information about it. I can definitely find out if that's of interest to you. I was surprised this, I didn't even know we did something like this. The late fees on dog licenses is something that currently what we do is we charge a $10 licensing for an altered dog, $20 for an unaltered. And the dogs must be licensed by March 31st, or they incur a $10 fee on April 1st, and then $5 each month thereafter. By May 1st, they also incur a $50 bylaw violation if they're not licensed. What we're proposing is to keep the fee, to cap the fee, so $10 or $20, depending on if you've got an altered or unaltered dog, and then at the May 1st, you know, do the $50 bylaw violation, so they're looking at $60 or $70. And then when we cap the fee, we're able to lean it against the tax bill if we need to. Because if it keeps growing, if the number keeps growing, we're not able to lean it. So this would make it so we could do that. And at the time that we would lean it, we would add $150, $75 to report and $75 for release. And we do that all at the same time when we lean, so that the $75 release fee can be included in the lien. And if the owner is not a property owner, we're looking to do the same process where we would take it to court if it goes long enough. And so this would provide a little bit better, you know, so that we can cap it, gives us another instrument and we can lean against the property.
Sharon, what's the time frame that is being described in the second bullet on the right? Is it a year? Is it
well,
6 months?
We were saying potentially 9 months, but we're trying to get our hands on, we're looking at the law regarding municipal charge liens, and it doesn't actually specify, so we're doing a little more research to figure out how long before we could actually lien it. And that's the reason I don't give it, because it's instated in the area for the liens on municipal charges. We were assuming it would be 9 months to a year. Not entirely sure, so I didn't want to put it out there and not know that it was entirely correct, and you can certainly get that before you ever think about voting on it.
So that really represents a fee reduction and a recovery process,
yes,
which I kind of like, because the way we do it now, the thing could turn into, I mean, I've seen that.
And it does.
It turns into hundreds of dollars, and the dog has gone.
Yep.
They don't want to pay.
Yeah.
We have no recovery system. I like this.
I mean,
this actually.
It seems like it would be less
practical.
The growing of it, I would think $5 each month thereafter, I would think that it could get very expensive. For
so March, April, it's 10 or 20.
Yeah.
May, it's not, I'm sorry, not in the future. We
get
rid of any kind of fine other than the $50 bylaw violation.
Yeah.
Right.
So, what, be
so
doing
the 10 or 20 is the original.
Plus this the is the original.
Right.
This is
right.
The
yeah, so they got a $50 fine, and we have a recovery system for it if they're a homeowner.
And
yeah.
Then they're going to in for $150 if we get to the.
Yeah, I mean, it's going to cost them $220 should it go to the recovery system that's detailed here. But that, I mean, I've seen these things twice that. With no way that, you know.
And the town clerk is on the corner and she can show you she can show you the scars.
Sure,
the clerk's office and the clerk's staff puts in an enormous amount of time on this issue every year. The town spends, not in addition to the energy, a fair amount on postage and keeping reminding people and finding them. And this would just simplify
yes.
all the
yeah.
workload.
I really like that.
Is there a notification element that we?
We probably still should do one. Before the May 1st and explain exactly what the procedure would be.
I would assume you didn't put more than one, just happenstance it doesn't get delivered or doesn't get
noticed. I don't know.
I can answer that. Currently, we send out a notification in March. We send out in January with the census. We send out a notification in March. There's an email sent in April. If I have an email address. And then the violations go out in May.
So we sell mailings to help them.
So you get two mailings before you run it to 70, and then you get a third before it goes to 210 or 230.
Correct.
Okay. That seems reasonable.
Excuse me, John,
do you have a
question?
Oh,
on the dogs.
What happens if the dog has passed away? That's what happened to my dog this year.
I don't have a good answer.
I mean, why send out a reminder? I mean, she's been she's registered for a lot of years, and I didn't re-register.
So that's the same case I've heard, where you have a homeowner, a dog owner, the dog passes, and the disconnect is the dog's gone, right? Mm-hmm. So the dog's gone.
Well, if the dog was if the dog passes in the year that the violation was issued, then the violation is voided. So, for example, we had someone that had a violation in 2011, 12, and 13. In 2014, they told me the dog passed in 2013. So 2013 and 14 was voided. The dog was here in 11 and 12.
So that's a two-year look back, two years credit.
Correct.
Hopefully a person, if their dog passed away and they start getting notices of that they've got this, you know, call and show that they would come in and tell
I
hope we wouldn't get to a lien before you realize.
We had this personal experience twice in the last 2 years, and when the census came, my wife went in and said the dog was gone, and that was the end of it. Just kind of, you know, it was taken off of there.
You're always describing a pretty common natural human.
Yes, I think this happens to a lot of people. And, you know, I think it's just as simple. Am I right, Laura? Is it just as simple as coming in and advising you, or advising?
Coming
you?
In, calling, yeah. Sending in a notice. The problem that we have that creates an issue with some citizens is that they send back a notice and with their census saying that their dog had passed, using the little slip that we send out, but they fail to put their name on there. And it gets set when we open up the census, it gets separated. Mm-hmm. So we have no idea what dog passed away. So what we do is just, you know, hope that they do get in touch with us before we actually issue a ticket. But, you know, that happens a lot, to be honest with you.
The next section, I'll take a couple of slides. Not many of the board members were here the last time we really had a serious discussion about this, but as you all know, we have a $25 resident sticker that handles both parking at the depot and compost stickers. Mm-hmm. Just to look at the parking elements, again, the MBTA in their what used to be two lots at Woburn and Vine charge $4 a day. Very nicely, the assistant town manager talked them out of the Vine Street lot, so the town now uses that for free. On average right now, they're 95% full and they get $983 per space per year. So that they're generating about $70,000 a revenue. In Reading, we have a couple of different kinds of stickers. There's a variety of business stickers, Blue Zone Parking and the like, and we make about $70,000 on 228 spaces in that space. And then separately, this $25 a year sticker, we realize something like, well, we have $80,000 for the combined uses of both the depot and the parking. We're never exactly clear on which is which, but we can look at the seasonality and make some estimates. And to be real simple, it's about two-thirds compost and one-third parking. That's a rough guess. One of the factors that I never explicitly mentioned, and I really felt I had to do it this year, is just to remind the board and everyone that the town pays over $500,000 a year to have a train station. That is an explicit line item in the state budget. That's less state aid that we get. So if the board is interested in assigning, you know, cost per user, this is an example where folks who use the train station are getting a benefit. You know, for $25 a year, they're able to park there instead of paying $880 to the MBTA. And it's costing us in state aid. So I just think it's important that, you know, the board keeps that in the back of their mind. On the next slide.
So the net cost to us to have a train station is $440,000.
If you want to look at the revenue that way, yes, you're right. Yeah.
I don't think people realize that.
I don't think so either, which is why I thought I should make it a little clearer.
We can certainly split the compost fee from them.
And that's my suggestion on both these slides, that at the very least we split them into two stickers, and then you debate each on its own merit.
Right, I'd see the merit in that.
For this one here, for the, if you go to the next slide, Sharon, for the compost stickers, that's okay. Again, I think this one is less egregious, if you will, on price. to run the compost center the way it is costs us about $60,000 a year. As you know from the prior dirt pile discussion, there are some hidden costs. We need to clean up the site. And honestly, the board should think about it, and we should all think about in the long run, 10, 20 years from now, do we really want to be in this business? Because you can pay the current garbage collector to take more leaves. We, you know, it costs about $25,000 right now to do 5 pickups a year. Obviously, we could do more at a price. So do you really need this site? For now, yes, but you know, in your planning for the future, we need to think about it. Again, the revenue for this site is a guess of, say, $50,000 for the compost center. So it's more or less paying the actual operating costs that we have to run. It's close enough, certainly. It's not worth arguing. I would argue that there's different ways the board can look at this. You could add more leaf pickups. Certainly the neighbors down there would appreciate if there's less trips. 40,000 trips a year is a lot of trips into a neighborhood. I think there's a lot of things to think about, but I would urge you to think of them separately as two different issues. One is the depot, and one is the compost center. And we can have, you know, further discussion during January, during the budget meeting.
Well, it seems the two of those being combined is really where the problem is. I mean, you know, people that go to the compost center are probably pretty happy with what they're spending to be able to go to the compost center. They don't necessarily, in many cases, ever park at the train station.
And we did a survey 3 or 4 years ago, which was kind of ill-fated from the start, but we thought we'd try it. Why do you buy a sticker? And the answer was both. Mm-hmm. Almost everyone said both. All you have to do is go to the train station once or even think about it, and that's justifying your purchase. And just to be clear, we're planning that the program not change for this January for us. This is something the community would now need a lot of lead time. So I wouldn't even suggest any change to this till a year from now. If you want to discuss it in January for January of 2016, I think that's appropriate.
Yeah, that might even need a multi-year phase in.
Yes, it might. Yep. So if you summarize the whole discussion on fees, the first section, if you will, you're probably looking at $25,000 to maybe $50,000 at the outside of additional revenue. Mm-hmm. This one could be potentially more.
That's the one
that
has the potential,
yeah.
That's the end of that.
So a total of 100.
Depending, you know, for right away for the next year, 25 to 50 after that. Yeah. And again, the thing I hearken back to on the parking spaces, since I now don't commute into Boston, I can say this. you know, it used to cost $25. Well, it does cost $25 a year as a resident to commute to Boston, which is great. For a non-resident, I have friends who come to the MBTA lot in Reading. If they go the typical business year, they're spending $800+ a year to do the exact same thing the Reading resident's paying $25 for. Is it a great benefit to the Reading resident? Absolutely. Do they know that it's really that much of a deal? I don't know.
Well, and does the rest of the town really want to be subsidizing my parking?
That's ultimately the question is, right? Where's the balance? If it's 25 and that's what the board thinks, that's fine. You know the budget situation we're in.
It's probably an area where you could easily justify some adjustment just on the merits and the disparity between, mm-hmm. even if it were.
Well, Dan mentioned the phase-in, which is probably
just 50 or 100.
You know, I mean, if you chart it out, over, we'll say, a three-year period where it grows from 25
to several hundred.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I don't think that, you know, a resident, you know, should be getting the deal.
I park there every day. I think that it's too low. $25 is too low. It's like a dime a day.
You just started the
method by which we
it's
get
nice, there. But I mean, really.
But it's an area where
you're agreeing with the destination. You're just making a motion how to get there over.
Well, I'm not even making a motion. I'm just suggesting that we need to look hard at this one because.
I agree.
Sounds like there's room on the board to do so.
Yeah, there's room here, and I think people will understand it. And I, you know, some people, you know, maybe in their budget planning. I mean, you have to jump to it right away. Maybe not.
We'll deal with these in the air.
Yeah.
Yeah. So we can talk to this.
Yeah, I can email it to you.
Yeah, that'd be fine.
Why don't we return to our cheap seats?
Those those probably come off the spreadsheet too. All that stuff comes off the spreadsheet.
I have all the backup that from the department heads. I can certainly provide that if you can.
It would be great to.
To see what their analysis is, yeah.
I'll do it later. I'm not sure, so.
Okay, next on our agenda, I guess we'll turn the lights back on.
Laura, would you mind hitting that, those switches?
It's kind of mood lighting. I was kind of. Next on the agenda is voting our subsequent town meeting warrant articles. So in our packet tonight on page.
18.
Thank you. 18. 15. Are the subsequent town meeting articles. So I'd suggest that we, for the ones that are not.
So 1, 2, and 4.
Are not statutory.
Are not, we would not support those because they're just standard articles.
Correct.
4 is going to be postponed.
I'd agree, but the ones that are not appearing in every warrant, I propose that we, one by one, have the board go through and take a posture with regard to whether we support, whether we do not support, or whether the board does not take a position.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
Prior to the statement.
Just stand up and introduce yourself, Bob.
My name is Robert Corwin. I live at 199 Summer Ave. I'm right smack in the middle of the proposed Summer Ave Historical District.
Actually, Bob, I mean to interrupt. If we could hold that discussion just till we get to that article.
Okay. I thought you didn't mean we wanted to get it out there in the beginning.
No. We'll go through these in order, but we'll get to that particular one in a moment. Thank you. Sorry to. Let's see. In our draft motions tonight, we have motions for each of the articles. I don't see any reason to take on 1, 2, 3, 4. 3
you probably want it. Capital improvement plan.
Yeah, all right. All those in, I guess the way to do it.
I'll make the motion, if you want.
Please.
Move the Board of Selectmen recommend the subject matter of Article 3 of the 2014 subsequent town meeting warrants.
I'll second that.
Thank you. Marcy seconds. Any discussion?
That is the capital improvement program for FY 2015 through FY 2024.
Okay.
And if the board looks on page 19, there's only two small changes right from the September town meeting, both in school facilities.
Okay. Any other discussion?
No.
Seeing none, all those in favor of the motion, raise your hand. 5-0.
Yeah, we're going to postpone 4, so I don't think there's any need. Article 5 is the amending the fiscal year 2015 budget. Moves that the Board of Selectmen recommend the subject matter of Article 5 of the 2014 subsequent town meeting warrant.
Do I have a second? Marcy seconds. Discussion.
If I might just give you a quick explanation. On page 21, there's the capital that was previously approved in September plus those two small issues from an earlier article. Then there's some housekeeping for the accounting side of the house. We're going to lead an effort to have a regional housing services coordinator, so we just need to recognize the expenses and the revenues properly. It's neutral from a budget standpoint. As Finance Committee discussed last Thursday, we're all comfortable improving our excise tax forecast for the current year. So the bottom line is 600 plus thousand of free cash will be suggested to be used at town meeting. Although you've not seen it formally, the free cash has been certified at approximately $1 million higher than it was a year ago, despite the fact we used it as much as we could last year. So I think the key is just keep using it and it comes back.
Okay. Any other discussion? All those in favor of the motion, raise your hand, please. 5-0. Thank you. All right.
Article 6 is the roadway easement for the Walker's Brook Bus Shelter. Move the Board of Selectmen recommend the subject matter of Article 6 of the 2014 subsequent town meeting warrant.
Do I have a second? Marcy will second the motion. Any discussion?
I have a little bit of background. The board has seen this and seen victory declared on this, but we were a little premature in that. The owner of the Stop and Shop in town is a Dutch company, Royal Ahold. they are not interested in cooperating, to put it mildly, and it's not because they're disagreeable, they're just not interested in cooperating. So when we suggested we could take town meeting action to relieve them of this responsibility rather than feel threatened, they were thrilled.
Please, please bring remnant.
An easement for, you know, very small money, you know, $10 or less, just simply gives the town the right to put in the bus shelter for the benefit of mostly the customers and the employees of the business Stop and Shop. The bus shelter was purchased a year and a half to 2 years ago. It's been weathering down at the DPW yard quite nicely. So there's really no opposition to this. It's just an odd path to get there, I have to say. I wish the parties had been a little more agreeable along the way, but this is the path they've chosen.
It's a disinterested proponent.
Yes.
Any other comments? If not, all those in favor of Article 6, raise your hand. 5-0.
I have a question on Article 7. Marcy, is that part of the general reconstruct of the zoning bylaws, or is that a standalone?
This is a standalone.
No, it's not.
In as much as it's a standalone, we kind of revert back to our normal policy of not taking positions on zoning articles. It's up to the board. That's really up to you.
What's the consensus of the board?
I'm thinking if it's not part of the master rewrite,
no, it's really, not part of
it's, part, yeah. It's kind of, we've acknowledged that because one of our members is chairing it, you know, we're following that. The idea of suddenly starting to, you know, take a position on when we're not sponsored, I think is probably, why would we change on that?
Okay. So any other comments?
I'm not planning to make a motion there.
Okay. All right. So we'll take your position on Article 7.
All right. The article is the Zoning Bylaw Comprehensive Update, part one of several, one that will be dealt with
this committee.
Yes. I'll move that the Board of Selectmen recommend the subject matter of Article 8 of the 2014 subsequent town meeting warrant.
Do I have a second? Marcy will second again. Any discussion? Bob?
Yeah.
Anything?
It's a very complicated situation. I can give you a 2-minute overview if you want. If you think of all the zoning changes that have occurred or are desired to occur, they are proposed right now to happen over 4 town meetings. One of them is in our rearview mirror, September. Article 1 failed getting 2/3, so that'll be brought back in April. The second chunk of articles, which we all describe as the real core zoning that have to sit together and either sink or swim together, right, as one article, is November town meeting. Then in April town meeting, in addition to the Article 1 brought back again, there's 4 other articles that can all stand or fail on their own merit, so they'll be separate articles as Article 1 will be. And then at the very end of all this process, should all those pass, a year from November, we'd consider the final article to move all the definitions from the various sections that they're in, if they're not already centralized, and centralize them all. So that's more of a house cleaning issue, if you will, at the end.
And if I can just add in, so and in the one that's coming up in November, any of the ones, there are several different things that would potentially be controversial. Those things will not be addressed until April. But what will happen is they'll be reorganized so that now what we have is the core, all the core things that have to pass at one time, plus reorganization so people can actually use what's there more easily than in the past.
And if I can add, the selectmen have in front of them their draft warrant report, which on this article is pretty much set. But you should be aware there's a significant and substantially large handout that every town meeting member will get to also supplement Article 9. So there'll be a copy, it's even impossible to describe, but there'll be a copy of the proposed new language and all kinds of charts on how you get from where we are now to how it's proposed to be. So, you know, if town meeting members are very interested in minutiae and detail, yeah, they really should read this in advance, not on the floor of town meeting, because it will explain probably at least 90% of the questions that might otherwise come up.
Isn't there a zoning CIC meeting this week?
There's actually one tomorrow night. Tomorrow night is the forum, the public forum in advance, so if anyone's watching this, please come. That's a good time to bring up your comments, bring up your questions. And
is it here?
Here.
Yeah.
It is here, yeah.
Okay, 7 o'clock, 7:30?
7:30.
That's really the lesson from town meeting was just how hard it is to deal with the minutia and the responding to questions from those who've seen this for the very first time on town meeting floor. Mm-hmm. It's both natural and inevitable, but it's really disruptive to the process. It takes the oxygen right out of the room.
It's so interesting to see the town meeting members who have taken the time to read the article or attend the meeting and, you know, and get their questions answered in advance and how they speak about things compared to people that are walking in with their little green book and, you know, start to read it, you know, as the motion is being put on the floor. I mean, the difference is so evident, and it does take the air out of the room. I mean, that's how it turns into 11:45 at night.
And the merits of the question are lost on most of the folks in the room as we kind of go through the minutiae and the clarifying questions. It's natural, some of it is inevitable, but something this thick, we're simply not going to get through it unless, to your point, John, everyone reads this. Mm-hmm. So.
And one more comment, just from an organizational standpoint, this is a couple nights or three-night town meeting anyhow. Yeah. So the proposal, which will be communicated at town meeting well in advance, is to start Articles 7 and 8, two zoning articles, on the second night of town meeting, and then do as much as we can on the first night, perhaps even jumping over 7 and 8 if we get that far ahead. Since there are so many reports under Article 1, I don't think we'll be getting that far ahead, but just so you know. And the presentation on Article 8 will be substantial in time.
Okay. Any other discussion? All those in favor of the subject matter of Article 8, raise your hand. 5-0. Before we move on to Article 9, there are folks here that would like to speak on behalf of the Article 9 subject matter. Sorry. Mr. Corwin.
So I'll say it again.
You have
Robert
the floor.
Corwin, 199 Center Ave. I'm here not only as a homeowner and a resident of Reading, but also as a 01867 neighborhood preservation representative. 01867 neighborhood preservation represents currently over 500 lawn signs throughout Reading supporting our cause. Over 600 supporters of the 01867 Neighborhood Preservation Facebook page, and over 900 residents who have signed petitions in our support. In addition to 20 of the 22 or 91% of the property owners within the proposed Summer Ave Local Historic District, about half of which are with me tonight. On their behalf, when it comes to your vote on the warrant article for the Local Historic District, I'm here to ask for your support in recommending the article to town meeting in an important effort to preserve the fabric of our neighborhood and the history and character of the town of Reading for generations to come. Thank you.
Bob, can you clarify that the two homeowners that are, first of all, you're representing 01867
Neighborhood Preservation.
The subject matter of Article 9 is actually from the historical district.
You are correct.
What's the connection, what's the relationship of those two entities?
We are in full support of the historical commission proposing this.
So you're here in support of it.
And historical district.
Yeah. The local district. Who are the, who, do you know the two homeowners that are the 9%? And do you know the nature of their objection?
We actually haven't been in contact with them, which is why they're not included in our sale.
So are they abstaining or are they voting?
No, we haven't gotten their response.
So of the 25 houses?
22.
22 houses, you've got responses from 20 and nothing from the two remainders.
Correct.
Okay. Any questions by the members of the board?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Can someone comment on how the boundaries of the district were arrived at? Because I noticed that the northern end, the district seems to truncate in the middle of a block past King Street on the one side.
Oh, okay, yeah.
What was the rationale for it not going all the way up to Mineral? Was there a rationale?
It's past Mineral.
Originally
it was only going up to King.
Yeah.
And then the historical district weighed in on that. And I think Kathy Greenfield can maybe speak to that a little bit.
Want me to speak to that?
Sure.
Also, Kathy Greenfield, 192 Woburn Street, and also on 01867. That's actually a decision that was up to the West Street Historic District Commission, so we weren't that involved or involved at all in creating the boundaries, or just aware of what they are. I think that there may have been some rationale to capture on the east side the Wisteria Lodge, so it was going to actually naturally end maybe at King Street as a boundary, and they wanted to capture Wisteria Lodge, the I forget the number, but I think you know what it is. It's the one two past King.
Was it 146?
Glen, yep.
Yeah.
And so they went that far on that side. And since it had crossed King Street, maybe captured the first house as well. The second house was not, the second house after King Street was not included, I believe, because it's, because it was altered so dramatically in the past and is not historic.
Do you know if the historical district group noticed each home, delivered a notice?
Oh, absolutely. Sure.
So that all the proper format was followed.
Yes. And they've since been received legal notice of the hearing. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Thank you.
And they held a question and answer here in mid-September as well. Problem.
Any other question from the board?
Yes. So is there anyone here from the historic district?
That's a bit odd.
Okay, so you guys as 01867 are asking us to endorse this article that we did not sponsor, and nobody from the historic district is here that make that same request.
You mean from the historic district commission?
Yes.
Yes, correct.
Okay, and then, so, you know, that begs a certain question for me, just in general. The other thing regarding the historic district I just want to kind of say out loud is that I believe there is isn't there a public forum coming up, a public hearing on this on the 27th?
Right.
27th, is that a Monday night, is it?
Monday.
Yeah. Which I'm very anxious to attend. I will just say personally, I would love to see this house preserved in question. That's just a, you know, that's not speaking as a selectman, I'm speaking as a person. But at the same time, as a selectman, in order to be able for me to vote on supporting this, which would be out of our norm, we normally, as previously stated, don't take a position on articles that we have not sponsored. This may be something we want to make, you know, an exception. But if that's the case, personally, I don't know how I could vote on it until I get to hear from people. I mean, that's kind of, I think, get elected to listen to what everybody has to say in the including you folks, you know. And, you know, you've been welcomed here, and I've had opportunities to speak, and I think you should continue to do so. But personally, you know, I'm going to have a hard time doing anything but abstaining until I have an opportunity to, you know, hear what's going on in the public. And then I guess the other question is, there are 22 homes, is that right, in this historic district?
I count 25, which is another question I have, is are there 22, are there 25?
I can clarify that.
Sure, thank you.
Okay. There are 25 parcels of land. There are 23 owners of those 25 parcels, because two owners own two parcels. At 186 and 190.
Yeah, I didn't count hers.
And the UU Church has two parcels. So that's 23 owners.
And of 25 parcels.
Of 25 parcels. And the number 22 Rob was referring to is one has already essentially abstained when we've asked for, you know, their support with the district, and that's the UU Church. They said they felt that it's a residence issue and should be determined.
Right.
They didn't want to take a position.
I know as individual members, the town meeting members on the board can certainly speak as town meeting members when this article comes to the floor. To echo John's point, I'm surprised that the
Historic District Commission wasn't here to at least answer some of the construction questions. And there's also in our packet tonight a letter from council of Criterion Child Enrichment that takes issue with the legal status of this area being declared a historic, an extension of the Historic District Commission.
In terms of how it applies to the...
Whether it applies, is it an end around the Dover Amendment? I'm not an attorney and I refuse to play one on TV, but it's really hard to have that conversation in the setting when half the room is empty. Bob?
I can shed a little light on that. There's two specific letters in the board's packet tonight. You folks have probably seen both. The first one is from August from Criterion, a lawyer from Criterion, saying that, you know, any action such as the one that's taking place at November town meeting is not proper. There's another from, I believe it's 01867's attorney that says, well, here's all the reasons why it's perfectly fine. So those are the two sides, if you will, of the legal battle. Our town council has looked at the issue, not as deeply as either one of those. He agrees with your attorney. If he did not agree with your attorney, this article would not be on town meeting warrant, just to be clear. We would not ask the selectmen to put a warrant article in front of the town meeting to jeopardize the town in some way. So, you know, he was comfortable enough to allow the selectmen to go ahead and close the warrant article, not that they had a choice. Westside Historic District, local district did it. But just to throw a couple more pieces of information with the board, I had three different conversations with the chair of the West Street Historic District Commission today, Everett. He emailed me, then he came in, and then he emailed me again. Some of it was to provide the content in front of you for the background of the warrant, which I was very appreciative of having. When he came in, I asked him a couple of different questions, and one specifically was, did anyone object in the district to this? And he said it was very strong support. I said, that's not what I asked. Did anyone object? He said, yes, one resident that lives in the district strongly objected in writing, but he wouldn't identify who they were, so I don't know. I don't know if it's the owner in question. I just don't know. I'll just share that with you. And then in an email towards the end of the day, which surprised me a little bit, and I just say this for what it's worth, he requested that the board not take a position on this article since you didn't sponsor it. He was requesting that courtesy. So it wouldn't be right if I didn't share that with you.
Thank you, Bob. Any other questions from the board?
Well, that could explain why nobody's here for the start.
I would suspect so.
And
that was sometime this afternoon, I understand.
You know, I think that there's an interesting fact. I mean, obviously, this is a very important topic in our town right now, and it's and feelings run very deeply and strongly. And the last thing I want us to do is to make that more complicated than it already is, because it's very complicated. There's, you know, a person, you know, trying to exercise, you know, their rights, and they're trying to do that. And then there's a group of many people, you know, trying to preserve a certain approach to how we do business here, you know. And I actually am very respectful of both of those. And I personally think when it comes to us weighing in tonight on this, in light of everything I just heard, I would rather wait until, you know, we have the opportunity, those of us that would like to attend the public meeting, and then, do we have another meeting before?
Yes.
That was going to be the next one.
Not before
yes,
the warrant
not
report
before
goes
the public
to public
meeting, but right. The night after.
And when does the warrant report go to bed?
That'll go to print. That'll have to go to print before.
So would it go to print, the and there could be a report of a vote at town meeting?
At town meeting.
Yeah, so I mean, it's not as though that can't be.
Right.
It's not as though we couldn't take a position
Between now and then,
we can, but it just strikes me that the prudent thing for the board to do is, I need to hear what everybody has to say, and you know, march forward. And I really value the, you know, Robert, your remarks on behalf of the group of people here who, in a very solidary way, stood up with you while you were making that. It's not lost on anybody, I don't think. I think that's great. So. That's where I'd be coming from, is that we defer anything, especially in light of what we've heard and what we've seen, and the fact that the person that's going to be actually making the presentation, that she was the chair, is that right, Bobby?
Yeah.
You know, that actually asked us not to take a position. I think we have to be respectful of that, especially tonight till more information is revealed.
John, if I may?
Yes, Bob.
I'll suggest that we, meaning Paula, will post the board for the 27th, so as many of you as wish can attend.
Okay.
And if that doesn't satisfy your need to have a conversation with the West Side, West Street Historic District Commission, we can certainly invite them the next night on the 28th to your selectmen's meeting.
Thank
you. Ought to have a full discussion, all parties involved, neighbors, everyone else. It probably could happen on the 27th, but if for some reason it doesn't, we can put a placeholder agenda item on the 28th.
So you're suggesting we post our next meeting?
The 27th.
Like at 7 o'clock?
I think you should be posted for the 27th in case more than three or more attend.
Do you know what time that meeting's posted? So
I think it's 7:30, but I'll make sure, absolutely sure.
Just echo John Halsey's comments. There are two sides in every argument, and as elected officials, we're bound to represent the interests of the entire citizenry. The merits or benefits or motivations behind the authors here are theirs and theirs alone. And while individually we may support or not support, it's really difficult for this board to take a posture that favors or disfavors this to the detriment or of the opposing side. Under the circumstances, I'm in a position where we ought to take no official posture, certainly before the 27th, and then we can convene with the Historical District Commission and chat with them. Does anyone on the board want to take a different position, or is anyone compelled to take up the vote tonight?
Well, that carried a lot of weight, what I just heard from the chairman. At this point, I would defer till we go through the hearing, and at least hear his reasons for not wanting us to take a position.
All right. Any objections to moving on and just taking the next article in order?
Okay. I'm here.
Why don't we do that? Thank you. Thank you all for coming tonight.
Thank you for coming. Yeah. I have a question, Mr. Chairman. Bob,
yes.
Is there any new information in Article 10 in terms of the police investigations of the alleged shots being fired?
My rear part of the room. Let me address a couple issues. In terms of the sort of public safety, and no, none at all. Mm-hmm. There's still no evidence, no credible evidence, other than reports of shots fired, that there was anything done in that specific neighborhood that can be proven. If you recall from that evening, the two folks in admitted that the direction that they heard them from may have in fact been a different location, mm-hmm. and that this article may in fact not influence, probably wouldn't influence the situation that originally intended, you know, made them come to the board. So the police have no updates on that at all. What the police did do when they worked with our GIS person is to put together some information, which I think is in here.
Right back.
Pages, it's in the 40s, let me find it. Page 50.
Oh, yeah. Sorry.
I also have this in a map form, which I'll put up. It's pretty visible from the
So this is distance. Speaking to the issue of a single lot being affected?
This speaks to the issue of how many areas in town could be affected by this proposed article.
Wow.
This one. And just for the board side, if I could, while Bob's searching here, to take us back to the night this article came before us originally. At the time, I raised a strong concern over the what I called unintended consequences of discussing and moving on the article prior to understanding the impact. And at the time, it was suggested, I believe, by the proponent, although I could be mistaken, that there were only two or three properties.
Right.
And it's unimportant. My point is one of process. I couldn't sleep that night. I went home and I really felt bad on a couple of fronts. One is that we acted, in my view, in haste by virtue of not answering this question prior to taking action. The second is that the individual, the proponent, admitted that the action sought
was not sought for the reason stated, but it was sought to impact and change a right which they thought was inappropriate. And to me, that goes to really the motives and the honesty, the fundamental honesty of what's driving people's motivations. So I really felt bad at the end of that vote that we had, for the best of intentions, and for what was at the night stated that had to be done that night to fit in the warrant, I just felt awful going home that that had gone down, that vote had discussion hadn't gone down the way that all of our other discussions have gone down, which is with a full discussion, a 360-degree view, and anticipation of, to the best of our ability, the unintended consequences. I wish I could go back in time and undo it, but I can't. But this page 50 in front of us is what I didn't know at the time, but was trying to raise in a clumsy way. I don't know how I could, with this in mind.
That's over I did a quick math, 43,560 square feet per acre. That's over 1,000 acres of hunting area. You're talking about that.
It's just the unintended consequence. It might be the right thing to do, but it doesn't comprehend the impact of this. And none of our discussion did. So.
True.
I'm getting a little bit ahead of ourselves, but in the subject matter of Article 10, I can't support it. I mean, that night I abstained after a discussion which ultimately had us revoting. And tonight I feel even more strongly that I can't support it. I'll open the floor for others that might have some other comments.
Mr. Chairman, I feel very much like you do. As you all remember, I abstained immediately because I believed that there were multiple. I thought the process was flawed, frankly. And I say that because, you know, for us to react to a change in the law that I'm not even convinced is going to be upheld legally. As applied to mass general law, tied to testimony of one complainant, I just felt that, first of all, if we were only dealing with one property, we could be discussing that property. But the way that this warrant is written, this applies to thousands of acres and, you know, it looks to me like scores of homeowners who have had for decades, if not centuries, had, you know, these hunting and sporting rights, and under very close scrutiny of mass general law. I know that the person that came in front of us was quoting high caliber rifles, and there was this whole litany of, you know, what could happen in, you know, 2 mile ranges. Well, you know, my research of the law is pretty clear that inside of properties like this, you can use a bow and arrow, and that is being done in many of these properties, my research also tells me, with permission and proper permit. And furthermore, the only firearm that's legal under mass general law is a shotgun, which has a range, you know, far.
Yeah, the exact language of MGL, if you want to hear it.
So, yeah, I mean, so, and I'll just finish this up and pass it along to you, Dan, but I absolutely cannot support this under any circumstances. If this came back in front of us in a public process with a public hearing, we heard from one neighbor of one property, and we're now looking at a proposal to change the law for 30, 40 people without any public hearing of any kind, without complaint, without support, without any process whatsoever. And I personally think not only can I not support this, I would urge my fellows here to push this in another direction, to the table, or, you know, indefinitely off in another direction. That's where I would be standing on this particular article.
Yeah, I echo the sentiments of two fellow comrades. The thing that also struck me was when the chief mentioned the number of investigations that have been conducted in the suspected area, with the complete lack of finding any physical evidence that weapons had been fired. That struck me as, if we're just chasing a ghost here, we're putting up a restrictive bylaw to cure a problem that maybe is caused by something completely other than what we're saying it is. And to the point I was making earlier, section 70 of chapter 131 of MGL is very restrictive about what can be used. The section is entitled hunting with rifle, revolver, or pistol, or by the aid of a dog, primitive firearms. Person shall not, during the open season when deer may be hunted lawfully with a shotgun, hunt a bird or mammal with a rifle, revolver, or pistol, or by the aid of a dog, or have in his possession or under his control in any water field a rifle, revolver, or pistol, or a dog. And then it goes on to say, notwithstanding the provisions of this section, the director may authorize the use of primitive firearms or shotguns with a rifle bore for hunting during any period when deer may be hunted by means of a firearm under rules and regulations promulgated in accordance with section 5. So state law is fairly restrictive already in the manner and type of weapon that can be used here. I'd see absolutely no reason for this bylaw change. Marcy.
So last time I actually did vote that we put this on the warrant, but I do want to say that having seen this big long list of properties that are impacted, I certainly can't support it.
Thank you.
Yeah, I'd just like to add in as well, Mr. Chairman. I think everybody was going under the assumption that there was one or two properties that was affected in town with moving forward with that bylaw. Looking back on this, this is something that definitely calls for, if this will move forward, a much more vetted process in looking at it. Originally, I was for it as well, too, but this is going to have a lot of consequences come down as a result if it moved forward, I'd feel. And at this point, probably needs to be looked at in its entirety, a little bit closer, with a little bit more of an open process. And if people are still in, or this board is still in disagreement with moving forward, it may not matter. And it may be up to a public person to put something else forward, not sponsored by this board.
And I just want to make clear that I was in favor of putting it on the warrant, but not necessarily supporting it until we had further information. So.
Okay. To that point, I think this speaks, and I'm very pleased to hear the comments from my two colleagues who put this on the warrant. We need to go, painful though it may be and slow and grinding though it may be, it is important to go through the proper process in getting the warrant articles on. I understand the proponent was in a big hurry to get this on, and we're all here to try to please people, but it just wasn't the right thing to do to rush it. We literally had this put on between the time we saw that packet in our email on Thursday and the time we showed up at our meeting. I've never seen that happen.
Well, the lesson learned, and you'll remember tonight, is the sentiment was we got to do this tonight to get it in the warrant. Yeah. Speaking just for myself, I don't ever want to be part of that again.
It, right.
It's a, no pun intended, it's a ready, fire, aim way of going about this, right?
Bob, did that proponent actually come to you and ask if there was a process for getting a warrant article on by petition? Did they ever raise that?
Only question? That night when she had some inquiry about whether her signatures would come.
See, if they had done that, they could have drafted the same language and put it on themselves with 10 signatures.
I don't want to handicap their activity. It's more what we do, which is I don't ever want to be presented with an act that requires us to act in haste and repent in leisure.
Yes.
So. Maybe that's a lesson learned.
But having said that, I'm pleased to hear the tenor of the discussion tonight. So,
what's the mechanism, if any, to Parliament in a parliamentary environment to defer or beyond just register the board's lack of support for this? Is there a means to propose that this be tabled?
The definitely first thing I would suggest is one or two of you work with me in terms of what language you want to put into print for town meeting. So you have a report under this article, you know, we need to decide what to say. It's one thing to simply vote, but it's quite another to explain why. And I think town meeting will need an explanation.
Agreed.
Once you do that, any one of the board or any any town meeting member could stand up and move to either indefinitely postpone or table the article.
Well, we could make that motion.
Absolutely. As the board rises to make the original motion, you could do that.
But that motion must be made on town floor.
Correct.
Can it be made tonight?
It would have no meaning tonight. And the moderator may or may not allow you to make the initial motion to table. I think it's okay. I'd have to discuss it. For instance, we discussed in Article 4 tonight. There's no prior year's bills, so the motion will be to table. This is not as black and white a thing. There's no reason to take action. The board just doesn't wish to take action. So the moderator has some discretion, and I'd have to discuss it with him. So I don't know what he'll ask. He may ask you to make the motion as originally, and then to someone else to stand up and make a different motion.
That's possible.
May allow the first motion to just be to lay it on the table.
Why lay it on the table if you want to vote?
Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
I would say that a stronger thing to do is to indefinitely postpone. Move for that.
Yeah.
On the floor.
Yes.
Yeah, I agree with you.
Because if you table, then that can be taken off the table later.
I agree. Sure.
Once it's indefinitely postponed, that dispenses with it absent reconsideration.
So Bob's first point, I think, is even more critical, which is the presentation to town meeting is going to have to capture the basis for the original vote, which this board did.
Fairly, yep.
The
fair and balanced.
Reason why, yep, the board as a whole chooses to alter its view if that happens tonight, and why that's a reasoned and thoughtful thing to do, so that those in the room that might initially misunderstand the motives and principles have a chance to kind of reflect on the whole circumstance and where we are.
I think it's important to take the formality of the vote to support and have that come out however it does.
Say that again?
Hmm?
Say that again?
I'm going to make this motion,
yes,
to approve, and then the board can vote.
Correct.
The
we
way
agree.
It
we agree.
Feels.
Why don't you go ahead and make the motion?
I will do that. Move the Board of Selectmen to recommend the subject matter of Article 10 of the 2014 subsequent town meeting warrant.
Okay, do I have a second? Marcy will second. All those in favor of the motion, please raise your hand. All those against the motion, please raise your hand.
Can I make a further motion?
Zero, five.
The
yes.
Move that the Board of Selectmen present as the primary motion a motion to indefinitely postpone the subject matter of Article 10.
What? Second. Hang on. I'm trying to make sure I understand. What bearing does that have tonight?
It's sort of advice to the moderator.
Note to self.
Notice to the moderator. This is what we want to do.
Okay. That's fine.
Second.
Okay. Any discussion on Dan's motion? All those in favor of the motion, raise your hand. 5-0. Thank you, board. We cannot ring the bell, but we can certainly go back and look at it.
No, but I think we need to be prepared, as Bob aptly points out. The moderator may choose to allow us to take a vote on putting this indefinitely,
right,
you know, postpone it indefinitely, and may not. And so that being the case, I believe that we need to be prepared to explain ourselves.
So, is that a debate motion?
So
postpone it, yes.
So
in fact,
what I would like to say is part of the reason I voted that to put this on the warrant is that the individual came before us, had 10 signatures, did not have it on the exact proper format.
Right.
But they actually made every good effort to do what they needed to do.
Correct.
To
the spirit of it.
And the spirit of it. And that is the reason why I voted to put it on the warrant. Because holding them up was really essentially balling them up in some very detailed minutia, which I'm sorry, most residents
don't understand.
They don't understand. So that was the reason why I went ahead with this. Now, seeing the information now, yeah, I don't believe that it's something we should move forward with as a Board of Selectmen. But that sort of gets to the reason of why I believe it deserved to be on the warrant.
Right. I understand your point, and I know that in the past when petition articles have been presented, if the petitioner does come to the town manager, the town clerk, they will work with the people to get that in ship shape, involve town council if they need to, mm-hmm, correct?
Correct.
They will work with the folks, so that should not be a barrier.
Yeah,
if it is a barrier, that's wrong.
They should have to proceed with this the way
absolutely
the way they want to. I mean, you know, that's the beauty of this whole, you know, of everything we do here.
I think if, they would still be free to present this motion. I mean, one of the town meeting members in the neighborhood, if they asked them to, could, I think, if they went to the moderator, he might say, you have to present, we'll let him present the motion then, and you can move to postpone. That's one possibility.
I presume, I don't know this, but I think I would certainly rise and speak my mind on this article. And I hope that my colleagues feel the same way. I think to the extent this is confusing for those in the audience, it'll be important to hear the rationale from each of us to triangulate what's going on or to get some clarity.
And we may take some brickbats, but we'll be
okay.
Bob?
And for clarity's sake, if one or two of you would work with me to write up a background, it would go to the town meeting members in advance, that would be most helpful too. I was gonna do it before tonight, and I thought I'd better really hear what you wanna discuss, because I'm not exactly how to short write up a background.
Do we have a, does anyone on the board care to volunteer to help write that background?
I would.
Yep.
Kevin and John.
Elaborate.
There you go.
Okay. Good. Thank you.
Thank you.
I see that we have some minutes to
approve the warrant.
Yes. That concludes the warrant. Thank you, Dan.
Sorry.
Next, oh, sorry.
Next, are we expecting a one-night town meeting?
What do you want to do next?
In November? No, absolutely no.
Did we skip over?
We did.
Well, we didn't do the appointments. Do you want to do that first?
Yeah. Why don't we just touch on the appointments?
These are probably awesome. Sure. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The volunteer appointment subcommittee met and interviewed two candidates. Because Mary Ellen Stolecki has asked to step back to an associate position on the recreation committee, that we have the opportunity to fill a full position on the rec committee. The young man and Dan Foley put his candidacy forward. He felt a very good fit for that role. And we were very fortunate to get a boomerang candidate in Rebecca Longley, who served on the CONSCOM back in the 80s. So every now and then we get a boomerang.
That's a long throw.
Yeah, I know. It happens. I was going to say the man who knows.
He had a long throw.
Man knows all of that.
So, you've seen their resumes. We were very impressed with both folks. So I'm very, Kevin and I, both happy to recommend them.
Do you have a motion?
I do. Move that the Board of Selectmen confirm the volunteer appointment subcommittee's recommendation to appoint Rebecca Longley to a position on the Conservation Commission with a term expiring June 30th, 2017.
I have a second. Marcy will second. Any further discussion? All those in favor? 5-0.
Okay, and Mary Ellen has tendered her resignation to the recommendation, so we are able to take this motion in the order here.
Okay.
Move the Board of Selectmen confirm the Volunteer Appointment Subcommittee's recommendation to appoint Daniel Foley to a position on the Recreation Committee with a term expiring June 30th, 2015.
Can you just second that? Thank you, Marcy. Any discussion? All those in favor? 5-0.
Move the Board of Selectmen confirm the Volunteer Appointment Subcommittee's recommendation to appoint Mary Ellen Stolecki to an associate position on the Recreation Committee with a term expiring June 30th, 2015.
Second. Marcy will second again. Any discussion? All those in favor? 5-0.
Thank you.
Next on our agenda tonight is the Town Manager Evaluation, and our package tonight on page 51. Are the summaries from each of us. I apologize in advance. I guess I had jumped over three, but I've since caught up. I'm not sure this reflects that.
That's okay.
You want to take us through?
Sure. There were, John and I, was a subcommittee that developed this reporting format. We took the 31 goals. There were several major areas in which these goals were set: administration, regulation and policy development, services, operations, health and safety, community development, infrastructure and capital projects, and finance. These are developed by the town manager and his staff and approved by the Board of Selectmen in the middle of 2013, I believe. There are numerous goals, objectives, and goals associated with each of these areas in which Bob was graded. We had a four-number rating system. Rating number one would be not applicable if there was a particular goal that had to be deferred or there was a good reason it wasn't met. That would be qualify for a one, and the ones did not count in the overall scoring the way I scored them. Two means the goal was not met That was progress, but insufficient to meet the goal. Three, the goal was met, and four, the goal was not only met, but exceeded. So there are a number of areas here. I don't know the most efficient way to go through this, if perhaps the board wants to highlight specific comments they made, their
the reason
summaries.
One suggestion is, you remember we narrowed this down to three criteria, did not meet and exceeded.
Yeah, it's 2, 3.
And then an NA. So if you looked at just the exceeds mm-hmm. and the did not meet, so we'll let it down to the vital few.
Right.
So just look at the composite rating as I run my eyes down.
Right.
I think number one to me was probably the most significant,
yes.
one of the most significant achievements. In terms of
that was the reorganization of the town structure, including the role of assistant town manager, described detailed transition plan for current status, and that included the reorganization of the town government and a part that was deferred, I believe, but for next year.
Right.
In part, at least, non-union pay and classification study results. So the result was a complete plan of reorganization, which put defense in depth in almost every major department. I thought that was probably the strongest move this year. You see this play on the police department. We have an assistant chief. We have an assistant, a couple of backup town managers in case Bob is out or doing something else. Building. Planning for succession is the hallmark of a great enterprise, mm-hmm. and we have begun to do that this year in Reading. We filled some enormous holes. I think one of them certainly was when Paula wasn't here. We felt her absence very dearly, and now we have some good backup for Paula, she's not here. So that I would like to highlight that one in particular. The collective bargaining agreements I also highlighted. Bob received a 4 in that area. I specifically, my comments called out my welcoming his not taking a positional bargaining approach, as I think previous town manager had done. Just leveling with the troops, letting them know what we're trying to achieve, and kind of getting down to the getting DS phase without a lot of positional jockeying, if you will. And that had a big effect on the unions. I think we settled quickly with a number of weeks. Some not so quickly, but the effort was greatly appreciated. There were some intermediate scores between a 3 and a 4, number 19 especially. The continuing progress toward meeting and maintaining the level of 10% of housing units. I gave Bob a 4 because through community development staff and Bob's leadership, have been able to shape where 40B developments go in this community. I understand Ray Meharis commented on it, so that's extraordinary. He's not heard of other communities where that's actually happened to any great degree. But Reading has been very good at being able to do that, to push back at times on the state. And it's because of the good progress we've made and good faith we've shown. And also the library building project, I think Bob stepped in and brought together some of the warring factions, if you will. Really got that back under control, on schedule, with some clear roles and responsibilities as to how he would fit into that process. And I think, unless I'm mistaken, things are going more smoothly. It'll never be totally smooth, as it won't be in any building project. But those are the 4 major, I think, kudos I would call them. Anybody want to add to that?
I'd just like to add again. For those who don't know, I was not able to fill out this town manager.
You're forgetting. You had a good excuse. Still do it.
For personal reasons that I had to attend to otherwise. But I did want to at least make some comments here tonight in regards to it. I did read through a lot of the comments that the rest of the board made. Kind of my feelings are with John Halsey and the overall comments. It's always difficult to rate someone that you've only worked with for a short period of time. But I do want to kind of emphasize a lot of the points that you'd made, Daniel. Some of the things that were impressive for Bob right out of the gate was, he had been in the system, as we say, so to speak, so he wasn't a rookie. but he certainly took the ball and ran with it right away. I think the reorganization was a big factor, something that seemed to be long overdue. And
his willingness to really tackle that is very tough in the first year. In doing so, I know we have a couple pieces to plug in there still, but that has really worked out tremendously. And I would just like to say, I find that most of the categories that we have in here, there's a lot of balls to in the air for a town manager. Even more so, certainly in the first year, even more so with a board that says, we want to get everything done right now, right away. So I think Bob's handling of himself in the last year in regards to all that has been well above par. And my comments are very favorable for him exceeding the expectations I think set out in a lot of key areas, which is the most important thing.
Well, and I just wanted to also say, overall, I mean, there's a lot of things on here that were met. There's some that were exceeded, but the fact that there are so many of them, and they were met, very few were put off, really, I think, is beyond expectations.
Yep.
It really kind of puts the, you know, I would say that things are definitely going in the right direction, and we've got some good attention to the things that we need to be paying attention to. So.
Right. Yeah, by my count, let's see, 24 of the 31 goals were either met or exceeded.
And just to close the discussion out, none of these are softballs. None of these are gimmicks. I think, remember, this is Bob's first year. Or this is Reagan Bob's first year in this capacity, I should say. And it's highly unusual, in my opinion, to find an individual who is so willing to hear critical feedback and take it in the spirit in which it's delivered and act on it. And such a positive manner. We don't always achieve our goals, but this kind of progress doesn't get met without a focus on meeting understanding the expectations and trying as best possible to meet them. I think we're much more mature in terms of recognizing 2 and 3 year goals. One of the actions I took, I think with you, Dan, is to now fit this into a larger matrix of how this fits into a strategic matrix. You know, for two members of the board, this is also your first year, and so this ought to be viewed as a real success story. And we ought to look at adjusting and amending the goals and as we go forward in the second, third year. Any other comments for you, Bob? Bob, do you have any comments?
Yeah, thanks to the board for their honesty, first of all. I'm not interested in praise unless you genuinely mean it. And not everyone that would sit in this chair, and this is no reflection on Peter, but I know plenty of people in other towns that would never say that and mean it, but I genuinely do mean it. The organization is only as good as the honest feedback it gets. It's as simple as that. So I do very much appreciate not only your kind words, but all of your feedback. I hearken back to the retreat we had at Jordan's Furniture sometime over the summer, with the department heads and all the selectmen, which is about a great gathering, and we should do it again. But I will say the one weakness we all identified that day that also sneaks through some of this is communication with the public, and particularly congratulating ourselves / marketing. None of us have time for that. We all need to find the time for that. And I'll take the blame for that in the sense that I have purposely left a department head position open to figure out what it is we really need, because it's a really crucial hire. I have some slightly different opinions than I would have last summer on that. I think we're in a position now where that person's job is clearly communications oriented. Mm-hmm. Having sat through the charter committee meetings over the last several months, not at my request, I don't know if it was one of yours, but one of the things they suggest the charter change is that the town manager do not have the ability to be the ombudsman, but designate a member of staff to do that. Because you can't run the organization and handle all the day-to-day phone calls and their interactions with the public. And again, that's not something I ask for. It is something I do. It's something I enjoy. It is something that is very hard to juggle all the time. So I think that, you know, communication over the next year is certainly a focus that we all need to have, and you'll certainly see it in your budget process. The other suggestion I'd have for the board,
and I'll try to work with you as you wish, is the review should, as some of you have mentioned in the past, should extend beyond goals.
Yes.
It should be on other qualities, mm-hmm. good or bad. Goals are tangibly measured. You can achieve all your goals and still have done a poor job.
Right. Mm-hmm.
You cannot achieve many of your goals and other things came along and you've done a nice job. So I'll work with you know, any group of you or single members of you if you want to go in that direction. But your feedback's not only helpful for me, it's helpful for the whole organization, because now I can share with all the department heads and everyone else, all right, it's your fault.
Well, their names were right on that cell for the USC.
But I was very happy with the feedback, and thank you.
If again, if there are any final amendments, omissions, numbers you didn't fill in, just get them back to me and we'll publish your final document.
How long do we have to do that?
Another week.
Another week would be great. Okay. Be very helpful.
Dan, you and I should try to get a schedule to try to fit this into that larger room.
Sure.
Yeah. Okay. We'll move on to the minutes of September 10th, 2014.
The Board of Selectmen approved the minutes of September 10th, 2014 as amended.
Okay, any amendments to the minutes?
Yes. So is this the right one?
September 10th.
September, they're at the back.
No, September 23rd, I think, is the one that I've got.
10th is under discussion.
Oh, no.
10th is the one we're on.
I have nothing to that.
Okay. Anyone else? Seeing nothing, all those in favor of the motion, the minutes is amended, or minutes is written, 5-0.
Okay, move that the Board of Selectmen approve the minutes of September 23rd, 2014 as amended.
Do I have a second?
Yeah.
Marcy seconds, discussion.
I have on page 5 some comments, I'll pass them to Paula. Changing the last sentence of the, under the sentence that starts, John Halsey noted. Change the second sentence to read, the town manager noted that the language of the petition that the marshal circulated is not in the proper format to be added as a petition article to the subsequent town meeting. So that was the actual thing I saw. So let me pass it on.
And I have got an edit, which is to the end of it's actually in the packet on page 72.
Okay.
And it's replacing the last sentence in the first paragraph on the liaison's reports. So what it should say is the policies of the light department are very old, and she noted that changes were made regarding the sale of renewable energy certificates and subcommittees while she served on the commission.
That's on the 29th, right?
Yeah.
That's a different set.
On the 23rd?
Page 72 is...
Page 72 is the new language. Oh, am I looking at a different packet than yours?
72?
Let's see. It looks like it's in the...
99.
Did it make any of the ones that were?
I'm looking at 923.
Yeah,
923. Oh,
yes, we're voting on 923.
We skipped over 923.
Oh, that's see. It's just double checking.
I got it.
Okay.
Yeah, we're here.
No, you're right. You're on 923.
This is 923.
You're on
923. 923. I'm replacing what's in 923.
Gotcha. Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Sorry.
Yeah. Agreed.
Any other amendments? Okay. All those in favor of the minutes as amended?
This is a financial forum one. Move the Board of Selectmen approve the minutes of September 29th, 2014 as amended.
Do I have a second? Marcy will second. Discussion. All those in favor of the motion, raise your hand. Those against? Abstain? So it's 4-0-1. Okay, if there is no other, I guess we have a...
Do you want to go back to liaison design?
Yeah, is there any, we did skip over liaison reports with the pinning ceremony. Is there any discussion? Liaison reports?
The only thing I wanted to say, and actually this happened when we had our last meeting, was that the measurement committee, if you will, actually we did meet just prior to our last Board of Selectmen meeting. So I met with Sharon Engstrom and with Chief Burns to talk about, you know, what different services and just start to think about what we need to do on that. So I just did want to let you know that happened. So we've got some lists of services and we have to start thinking about what are the regulations for services.
You think about metrics. Back to metrics.
Yep.
Thank you. Any other liaison reports? Bob?
If you will, on page 3 tonight, there's a little bit of an outline, but Right now, the Board of Assessors and the appraiser are planning on having an October 28th tax classification hearing. The board is interested.
Bob, I noticed that the hearing is already posted in tonight's
paper. We had to post it because 2 weeks' notice is required. Okay. Doesn't mean we have to hold it. You can open it and then
open it and continue it. Okay.
So the two choices are either then or November 18th, which is why I made that comment earlier when RMLD was here. On the 28th, as of right this minute, the assessors believe that the DOR will approve them and be no problem. They believe that they can get you plenty of material well in advance and be on call for the 5 days between when they get it to you and when your meeting is to answer all your questions individually. If that happens, they'll keep a record of all your questions so I can distribute it to all of the board on the Tuesday. There's nothing particularly interesting, I guess you'd say, in the numbers from what I've seen. Commercial is relatively flat, maybe up 1% or so. Residential is up more, 3 or 4%. But the difference is not significant, as some years it's been pretty different, where one was up 10% and one was down 2. It's not like that this year. If the board wishes, they can just do a preview on the 28th, mm-hmm. and then hold the actual tax classification hearing in November, whatever your wishes are. I would ask that if you do prefer to have the preview, I'm going to try to look for another meeting date before the 18th, because that's getting pretty late to actually have a classification and have the staff do all the work they need to get the tax bills out. But that doesn't mean we have no flexibility. We do. I just may try to move a meeting up before the 18th.
The first week
because of town meeting and Jewish holidays, it won't be a Tuesday in November. Okay.
Any thoughts in terms of the pre-hearing on the 28th?
Just that I'm unavailable the week of the second.
We've got two meetings posted immediately prior to the town meeting, and then
27th. Yeah. This is the 28th.
Yeah.
And that'll be a preview, and then the formal tax classification hearing would be the 18th. It is no other. There's no other dates between.
You'd like to get it in between the 28th and the 18th. Is
yeah.
That I understand.
Move it in.
It would have to not be a Tuesday, but I'll have to look for dates. I have to tell you that I'm booked every night, sometimes three times. But I can figure it out. Okay.
I'd be inclined to get a preview on the 28th, only for prep and review and feedback. What's the sense of the board?
Sure.
I personally think given the timing, I'm comfortable with doing my own prep with the package, if we can get the package, and having the hearing on the 28th is proposed.
I'm okay with the hearing on the
20th. Yeah. When would they have the, by the 23rd we'll have a package?
He's saying, yeah, in October, assuming the DOR is on schedule, which is a wild card, he should get you stuff on the 23rd. If anything varies from that, then he wouldn't suggest having the classification hearing on the 23rd.
Okay.
If he can't get it to you on the 23rd, that's a problem.
Yeah, I mean, I think if we could get it on the 23rd, I don't see any problem then.
And then if there are questions,
then you can do it on the 23rd.
We can do it directly with him.
And he said he would give you his cell phone,
one-on-one.
Be available all weekend, not a problem.
Okay.
That's why he's regionalized, he said.
I'm okay with that as well. All right.
That's the only thing I really wanted to ask the board. Thank you.
I've got a couple of short liaison reports.
John?
I attended the, it was a combination, at the Board of Health, it was a combination meeting and strategic planning session. It was a rather extended meeting. It was a 4-hour meeting, 6 to 10 o'clock. The first hour or so was dedicated to their meeting. They are in the middle of looking backwards now on their Tobacco 21 movement. They're urging neighboring towns who are not in the regional model that's in effect, and apparently Saugus, Linfield, North Reading, Wilmington, and Danvers have done the same thing that our Board of Health has done relative to the Tobacco 21 regulation, and they're preparing to send letters to neighboring towns that are not urging them to join the regional model. They also got a substantial amount of information and introduction by an interested citizen on the whole
tick thing. And Dave Mancuso provided a lot of additional information, and Ruth Clay made a decision to go forward with the, she went to a workshop at WGBH. I think Bob, you went with her, is that right?
No, I didn't go to that one.
Okay, somebody went with her. And they are posting a lot of additional information, you know, relative to that. The whole tick issue, which is not small. And about a 2.5 or 3 hour process ensued. They're being facilitated in their strategic plan. That did make a lot of progress, both in analyzing their public meeting that was earlier, taking the feedback from the dozen or so. Winchester Hospital was involved in their first meeting, Sanborn Place, police, local businesses, fire, elder services. All the feedback that came from that kind of open group has now been digested and homogenized by the facilitator, and they spent an extended period of time working on the kind of the overview of their plan. I would say it's probably 2 or 3 meetings away. They'll be having another one of these marathons that I'll be attending probably sometime next month. Also, the Recreation Committee invited me to participate in the kind of refabricated Birch Meadow Master Plan. They want to be sure they bring it up to date, because it was actually constructed unbelievably 7 or 8 years ago now. I mean, it's been a very long time, and a lot has changed.
Time flies when you have fun.
Yeah, and you know, and we've not been in a position to act on much of any of that plan, and it appears that we're getting closer to that now. So I continue to meet with them. They've been inviting me to it. They also invited me on a field trip to look at an indoor facility. It is very interesting. It is a revenue-driving indoor facility that is hosting lacrosse, but could, you know, host football, could host any variety of things. And it's kind of a combination indoor-outdoor facility. Very interesting. We're looking forward to looking at the financials of that, but to see what some people have done with recreation. This was in Wilmington. Apparently we're close to another field trip in Bedford, where they actually have a outdoor facility that now shortly becomes an indoor facility, because a bubble goes, you know, goes over the, you know, the track, and we're gonna show up when the bubble goes up, you know, on the next field trip.
Is this reversible kind of thing? You see it?
Well, yeah, what they do is when weather permits, it's an outdoor facility, and then when weather doesn't permit, it's an indoor facility, and has constant flow, you know, pretty much, you know.
Indoor outdoor athletics.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And more than athletics, it's recreation. There's a lot going on in these places, particularly the one in Bedford. I mean, it ranges from kids running around having fun to, you know, organized adult sports. So it's a little of all of that. All of it revenue driving, interesting. So I'll keep you posted as that develops.
Yeah, if you can send us where the address is too, I might like to take a look.
Yeah, I'll get that information and send it to you. Thanks. So that everybody's got an opportunity to take a ride by. And I'm sure we could arrange a visit inside. It's interesting, a Reading resident has been, a Reading business owner has been very involved in both of these projects, you know, as far as construction is concerned and so forth. So we've got some pretty good access to be able to look at it, and, you know, hopefully ultimately look at the financials. Kind of in that same vein, I took an extended visit to Ipswich River Park and, you know, visited with their recreation people and kind of saw a little different vision, that some of which may apply to the Birch Meadow project.
So. John, I know you're talking about financials. One of the other things I would be very interested to see, besides the income statement, is the operating model. How do they manage it?
How do they operate it? What do they look at in terms of energy or staffing or?
All of that.
All of the above.
And furthermore, we need to look at what kind of local job creation happened as a result of all of that too. I mean, there's a whole, I mean, there's a.
Traffic.
The operating model itself is.
Exactly.
Pulls all of that in. And, you know, I'm going to continue to work with John Feudo and with the committee. They're all very, as I've told you before, that's a very energized group. And it sounds like you've made a nice addition, you know, Kevin and Dan to that committee. The person that's stepping back was a very good and active person. Glad she's, you know, staying as an associate.
Yep.
And it sounds like you kind of filled the hole right off the bat, so.
We got lucky.
Yeah, it's good when that happens.
Thank you, John.
Yeah.
I have nothing to report.
Just one more thing since we started discussing the finances. Last Thursday, the Finance Committee met in open session to prepare for the financial forum at the end of the month. If you wind back to the last financial forum, we showed models that had about 1% operating budgets for the next 2 years. Finance Committee is still very interested in trying to take a two-year look, so we did that on Thursday. I'll cut right to the chase. We're now at 2%, and it's very unlikely to get very much better. Maybe 2.5%. But for the last 3 years, we've been at 3.5%, and you've heard all the complaining about how we're not getting all the work done. It's going to be tough, just to lay that right out on the table.
So the second year out looked a little rosier, I take it? You blended into two?
Not especially, no. 2% each year.
Yeah.
Is the way we looked at it.
1%.
As opposed to 1 and 1 or 0.8 and
1.2. Dan's asking if one got better because
no,
you had three following it.
It really didn't get better. It got better because we didn't spend more than 2% the first year.
No, that's usually the way they work.
Okay. John, I did have one other thing. Arcasa is having their opiate forum.
The 23rd.
The 23rd. I'd urge everyone to attend that can attend. Also, just to give you one other, you know, kind of liaison report. There's a group called the Improbable Players, which are they are people in recovery. They've been in business for 30 years. They visit schools. They visit PTOs. They put on stage plays with the idea of delivering a message. They also do follow-up work, you know, in the schools. And they work at a variety of different levels. It's a very interesting group. My wife and I went to their 30th anniversary celebration, which was a snippet of all of the things that they're doing right now. It was a fundraising event because they're a nonprofit. And they are engaged in a discussion with Arcasa about a program that could, that wouldn't, you know, the goal is not to have it fall on the school, but the, you know, in the idea of coalition, that there are many different contributing factors, and that maybe between the help of our Beacon Hill legislators and some local fundraising that could be done by some Arcasa members. That, again, back to the partnership,
sure,
the
private, partner.
Private, you know. So that's being explored right now. I found it to be uplifting. We spent about 4 hours, you know, with that whole group. There was probably 200 people there, and probably 50 alums.
Oh my goodness.
That dated back 30 years when they started in somebody's apartment. And it really is quite something. They have been in Reading already two different times, kind of a one and done thing. The thought is that maybe something more comprehensive could have more comprehensive results. So I'll keep you posted on that as we go along too, as part of the project involved with our cost.
Thank you, John. Okay, we have a motion to go into executive session.
Move to go into executive session to consider the purchase, exchange, lease, or value of real property and to discuss strategy with respect to litigation, and that the chair declares that an open meeting may have a detrimental effect on the negotiating position of the body, and not to reconvene in an open session.
Okay, this is a roll call vote. John Arena, yes.
Before I say yes, which I'd like to, Robert, have you come back because you have something else you want to tell us?
Okay. He's just dying to hear at the end of the
evening. No, actually, I just came out of the meeting. And congratulate Kevin on his acquisition.
So I would vote yes.
Thank you, Marcy.
Yes.
Dan.
Yes.
Kevin.
Yes.
Okay. Motion passes 5-0.
Where are we going?
We'll stay right here. I'll turn out.
And we have to take a look.
Can you take a 2-minute bio break?
I'm gonna check out.
It's great, great to see you. You can kind of stay home face to face.
Yeah, exactly.
We had a nice conversation this morning.
Well, he's going down a little bit.
Yeah. Appreciate it. Appreciate it.
I'll take it.
Thanks a lot.
Well, you know, it's always gonna pay back. I mean, you know, somebody else did it when our kids were little. It's our chance to pay back.
How you doing? I've seen you across the meeting room a couple times.
Hi, Dan. Robert Corbin. My pleasure.
By the way, if you ever have a 3-year span, you've got nothing to do.
But, you know, let me say, I put some time in on certain things, and I'm sure, you know, in the future, there'll be some time that definitely.
So now.
Devoted to more of this stuff.
So is the, the 20, whatever that is, 7, is that here?
I believe so, yeah. Yeah, I must be here. Yeah.
So, you gotta get to the biggest place you can get.
Right.
This is more public PR getting a message.
This is the required public hearing, as part of the process.
Got it.
And it couldn't be any sooner than the 27th, because it was a 60-day.
Waiting period.
Waiting period. Yeah, exactly.
You gotta fit into the windows of.
Correct, of process, whatever that is.
Aren't your attorney's telling me this is perfectly fine, it's no problem, because it's not prejudicial to the Dover amendment?
Correct.
The other side's screaming, so yes. I assume it does have a prejudicial effect on their outlook or their use of this.
Well, I think, to be frank, I think what they ultimately want is not what they have proposed. What they want is actually what they initially proposed, which was to
raise the property,
get rid of everything, start. And the specter of the historic